town was before.
Okay, let's think about getting going here.
I thought about it. It's a good idea.
Welcome to the Town of Hopkinton Planning Board meeting for Tuesday, October 11th, 2016. I'd like to thank HCAM for taping the meeting tonight. We've got two members missing, and they might need to hear that. We a special call out to Brian and Matt, who are missing today.
Hey, I didn't get one last night.
Today the agenda is relatively light. We have finishing up on our master plan discussion, which is our first item. Then we have continued public hearing on Legacy Farms to add the 180 age-restricted units. Then we have a lot of Legacy Farms type miscellaneous items to talk about, and a few things like planning board goals and minutes and all the normal stuff that we're at. So basically, and the last announcement I'd like to make is that the Zoning Advisory Committee will hold a public forum on Thursday, October 20th, 2016 at 7:15 up on the third floor right outside the building inspection office in the conference room, meeting room up there. Obviously, I think you're not expecting a lot of people, or that was, I guess, the only room available. But anyway, this particular public hearing, public forum, really is where citizens and committees can hear ideas and proposals for amendments to our zoning bylaws. This starts the process that this board will finish at town, or a town meeting will finish with zoning amendments. So basically, Zoning Advisory Committee, which reports to the Planning Board, will hear proposals. They'll decide which ones they're going to work on, and then we'll get them towards the end of the year, beginning of January, February, and get them all ready for town meeting. So anyway, with that being said, today we'll start off with a master plan discussion. Elaine, please join us. We left off the master plan discussion last time with a few comments. I don't know whether anyone gave you comments in between from there, and basically, because we were missing several members at our last meeting, we wanted to make sure that everyone had time to get their comments in. I know Elaine's got one page on water quality of revision that we were all given. We'll talk about that in just a second. And then particularly those members that weren't able to get comments last time or whatever, it'd be good to kind of get them into Elaine, and we'll kind of go through those for the next however long it takes. The end of the goal is, if we're ready, is to vote to release the draft for public and town committee comment and set the public hearing for November 21st. So that's the goal for the this discussion, if we're getting there. I'm going to start off with your water quality. The only one thing that I had with problems with there is, there's a statement that says, and those are not drinking water sources, Hopkinton Reservoir and Echo Lake, which are part, are truly there. So if you take those words out, I think everything looks good. Who has comments, who has discussion as to where we are on what we want to do?
On the water or outside of that scope?
You want to take the water paragraph first, because we had that all in our packet. If there's any further discussion on that.
I had one question, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
Since the last, I want to say draft, or last version of this was done, have there been any changes to in the three bodies that are identified here, Whitehall, the Reservoir, Sudbury River? Any changes? Were they Category 5 previously as well?
I have looked to see if there's anything that's been done since 2012, and I haven't found that there's a newer report. So I'll keep looking.
But pretty much status quo.
Haven't
more
found
just,
anything yet.
Yeah. Right? It'd be great to improve the quality of water quality.
Absolutely.
It might not be outside the scope of us, but
it's, yeah.
Well, when you're thinking about goals, it's something to think about. Yeah,
man, that's a legit one, I would think.
Mm-hmm.
I concur. Anyway, I just kind of try to get a data point on that, and maybe that, I don't know, somehow to address it in the goals.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Anyone else? John?
Do we want to add in just a little bit, the Open Space Preservation Committee has one of the major justifications for acquisition of land is protection of the water supply. So I thought maybe just adding a sentence related to that, maybe in the open space section, saying that that is one of the primary targets.
Didn't we have something like that somewhere?
It's open, but doesn't mention it as...
In our open space and recreation plan, that's one of the major, that's
okay,
one of the three major goals.
Okay, but I tie it in here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I actually have something. I just printed it off just for the fun of it.
That's a bunch down this way.
Yeah. They're all different colors because my printer ink was running out. So first of all, it says suggested improvements. That's a bad wording on my part. I just didn't go back and reprint it because this doesn't need much improvements. It's a very well-written document. And I think the first two items have kind of been mentioned before about adding pictures in.
Yes.
I just kind of called it out because I had added a couple of sections to the Wikipedia page for Hopkinton Online. So if you, I'd done some for historic homes and some for the public buildings. So if you want to use that as a reference.
Or if there's specific buildings you want us to include, let me know.
Well, if I may, through the chair, one of the pictures of the Hopkinton Mass overlay picture, I think that should take one whole page on the master plan so that people can, because what you have is you have that where it's not, maybe not that
one. What page
one.
Are we talking about?
Huh?
What page?
We're talking about, I believe, page 8. And 14. Page 14 as well. 14 says that there are special places in Hopkinton, Mass.
Mm-hmm.
And that's so small that nobody would be able
to
utilize
it.
That. So I think that one page in that master plan for just maps of that nature would be really cool.
Yeah, usually we have a section of maps at the end. We haven't done any maps yet.
Yeah,
so.
Okay. To that, and there are a few things that I noticed. Are you done,
Nope, I'm not.
All right, go ahead.
Okay, so those first two were just adding some, beauty or creative pictures to the document. The third one, and I don't. This is just a suggestion. I'm not saying we should do it or not. I just wanted to get some feedback from the team about whether we should add a list of services and their budget and their approximate number of employees. I don't know if that would be useful information or what people feel about that.
Yeah, I don't think the education department's only got 20 people, but that's...
did I mistype?
Probably
by
an order of magnitude.
Actually, that's supposed to be, I think...
222?
It's DPW. There's supposed to be flip-flop there.
Okay.
The question marks are supposed to be the education. Yeah, this is... You can... I actually... I got some of the numbers out of the Terson Kano report.
Yep. Elaine's good at finding facts.
Yeah, this is just
this is probably not a bad piece of...
Here.
It kind of gives a good feeling to it.
I agree.
I wonder if you kind of dated 1 year in, because it changes every year, doesn't it?
Benchmark. You could say it's a benchmark.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We could maybe look at it, what it is 5 years ago from now when somebody's updating it or whatever.
You can see the growth of the town. Just a thought.
Okay.
So that's kind of... And then the last...
I think there's some good places you can easily put that in without... hurting anything.
Yeah, I listed it as the community facilities and services section. And then the fourth thing that I didn't write here that I'm still struggling with and working with Elaine a little bit is somehow to get the sidewalk plan once we figure that out and where to put that and if we should put something.
On page 69, there's like a draft kind of one page placeholder for sidewalk plan, but if that has to get changed or enlarged or expanded, it's a place to start building that.
So that's under the transportation section?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. Thank you.
If I may...
Yeah, go ahead, Cliff.
Continue. All right, so I got a couple things. One is a clerical thing that I maybe want to see a little less of. On page 5, we have housing and residential development goals, and we kind of redundant on the 10% affordable housing goal twice in the first sentence of that in the third bullet of that. So maybe that's just a little redundancy there. I don't know.
I actually thought the same thing. So it kind of scares me that I'm thinking like you, Cliff. So.
Thanks a lot, buddy. Appreciate that.
Can I ask where you can, because there are two different goals.
But you can probably combine them in the same wording.
In the same wording.
Same goal, I would think.
Into that, I want anybody, I'll suggest this to the board. Does anybody know what Claflinville is?
Yes, because you've told me. But
yeah, but other than that.
Well, I do.
Okay, I'm going to give you a little history lesson real quick. When Hopkinton first was erected, we had woodsmen come in, and there were row houses on West Main Street. And the row houses used to be housing for the woodsmen to clear the land throughout Hopkinton, to establish Hopkinton. At that time, my grandmother, my great-great-grandmother, moved to Hopkinton probably in 1850s, roughly around that area. And Claflinville was the precipice of the entrance to Hopkinton. My great-grandfather was a woodsman. My grandfather was a woodsman, and his children were woodsmen. And they cleared lots all through Terry Farm, all through the high school, all through majority of Hopkinton by axe and saw, tree saw, hand saw. Through that process, also, they dubbed the area called Claflinville as a subset of Hopkinton, which is like Woodville. Nobody knows that, except maybe some of our older folk that are present at this time. My grandmother kept asking me about a stone, a granite stone that was erected for that area, and it was on our property adjacent to our boundary. And it's dated from the 1700s, and I did my due diligence and I found it. And I brought it home, and I offered it up to the Historical Society, and they took it, and it's now in the Historical Museum or artifact of thereof. I would suggest, and this is a suggestion because of the 495 corridor, that used to be called Four Corners, and it was called Claflinville. Maybe we can go back and erect some sort of recognition for that area to be noted as Claflinville, and we add that stone as a commemorative to the people that opened up the town of Hopkinton. Now, Sandy Altamura is one that lives on Elm Street who is of fifth generation, and I'm sure that she could tell this story better because she's related to the Claflinville, the Claflins. So I look at this and I say, you know, it should be noted because it is, we talk about Woodville, but really nobody really understands the magnitude of Claflinville. So I wrote up this little thing and it might not be apropos, but in the 495 corridor lies a commercial and multi-use space once known as Claflinville, which is currently becoming a gateway to our great town, and is noted by a granite stone marked in the of the epicenter of the once humble beginnings of what has become Hopkinton's welcoming place. So I maybe just that type of wording or something that gives recognition to that. And I don't know how, if there's any public people that would like to add to that or anything else like that, but I think that would be good for past historians and of the like. And I guess the last thing that I saw was that we just incorporate those maps to be separate from dialogue so that people can refer to them. And I'm done.
I got a couple questions. Did you give the stone to the historic guys?
I did.
Okay, so you ought to talk to them to see whether they were willing to give it back.
They talked about that with me, and they said that they would love to...
If it's found an appropriate spot, they're happy with
exactly.
it. Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. I just didn't want to promise something in a narrative that we don't have title to.
No, we really would like to showcase it.
Okay.
But, and again, it's very, very old, so...
Okay.
Just if I may, is that something we should run by the Historical Society just to get better clarification, or...
Sounds good to me.
Get it written up somewhat... Not that you didn't do a good job.
Is there some place where that might appropriately be put into a master plan? It's kind of a history.
I think we talk about the history of Hopkinton a little bit, so we can talk more about the villages, and, you know, we talk about maybe Woodville and Hayden Row, but we had maybe there's some other forgotten villages, so I can touch base with them and get a picture of the stone anyway, and,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Sure.
And then if you wanted to think about that as one of the, tied to one of the action items in the master plan, you can, you know, think about that.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Okay.
So through you, Mr. Chair, just a question on page 70. When we're looking at the improving the operational capacity at the following intersections.
Yep.
For Chestnut Street, can we suggest that there's separate left and right turn lanes?
I think that you don't want to necessarily go to that kind of detail in a master plan and just let it, I mean,
Sure.
I believe that's the answer,
personally.
But
don't need to capture it here.
I don't think you have to get that far if you talk about traffic signal.
Well,
you know,
question about the traffic signal, though. What does that mean? Does it mean we want to put a traffic signal there?
Maybe it needs to be potential? It says improve or investigate.
And they're all under the heading of operational capacity, improving the operational capacity, which could mean turning lanes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because we had discussed that in meeting anyway, was that we originally thought about the light and then retracted it, but said they would put the units in for future.
No, I think it's not in front of school.
Yeah.
This is not in front of school. This is Chestnut Street.
Oh, okay.
Do we have...
So these were separate items before, and I consolidated them. So, you know, make sure you read through, captured everything.
I think, did we lose the, I'll say, Hayden Row corridor from Chestnut to Grove?
Chestnut Street, Hayden Row, traffic signal, pedestrian.
So these are, those are intersections.
Right.
Those are intersections.
Current intersections, right, which... Two streets,
I think
right.
you might want to have a separate one that talks about the Hayden Row corridor, which is, you know, all the schools and stuff. And we, you know, we discussed
already
that.
Number three is improve the Main Street corridor.
Yeah.
Okay, so something like that for the
something
Hayden
like
Row
number
Row
three
corridor.
For Hayden Row.
Okay.
You know, for all the school area, because that is a mess.
Right.
It's going to get worse.
It's going to get worse.
And the lane. Just a real quick typo, and because it has a big meaning. The page 69, the first paragraph halfway down says waking is a basic and important component of the transportation network.
Okay.
Should be walking. Right?
Yeah, walking.
Yeah,
both are important.
Yeah.
Waking is, but walking is also.
Great. Thank you.
Any other comments on master plan? I think we're. I'm sensing a readiness to turn it over to other town committees, the draft of which we'll have Elaine incorporate these final comments in. So basically, I'd entertain a motion to vote to release the draft when finished as for public and town committees' review and comment, and to set a public hearing for November 21st.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
So about the 21st, so conservation's meeting that night to
I had assumed, would this room be too small for that kind of public hearing, or will this be acceptable to you, or do you want to try to get a different room somewhere else?
Let's see if there's some other rooms available, because we won't be able to use that. I'm trying to remember, 8-10 years ago, we had a bunch of people that showed up. I mean, it's one of those that mm-hmm. if people seem to be interested, they come. If not,
right.
you know, maybe they don't.
All right. So I can reach out to other
Did you say 21st of October or
November.
November?
I mean, you know, maybe a high school auditorium, if that might be available.
Or the middle school library over
middle
there
school.
For all the
lecture room.
Lecture room.
I'll find out.
I don't think the library meeting room will be ready yet. Particularly in November, it might be a little cold.
Have we ever had an instance where we have three major buildings under construction at the same time?
Not my memory.
Library.
Maybe two. Maybe two.
In the school.
Maybe two. Okay. Let's see. Let's get on. We've got 10 minutes before we continue public hearing. Let's talk about sewer connections on Clinton Street, because I know we've got a few people here from Clinton Street. We'll allow you guys to...
Before Lane leaves, did we want to talk about the roadway design standards discussion, or no?
This is David's idea, I guess.
Probably need some more time.
I think what we would like to do is maybe expand that and maybe look at our subdivision standards and what we're doing, and then that, and then maybe we have an addendum to that where we set up some standards for, I'm going to say, reconstruction. You know, might be part of what we try to do, but we obviously need to get John Westerling involved in
yep.
that,
mm-hmm.
and you know, and maybe make that a bigger deal than something really quick.
Okay,
and
I just didn't know while she was here.
But that's a good idea. I mean. So, okay. Now let's talk about sewer connections on Clinton Street. And Roy, do you want to come up? And
sure. Hi, Roy. How are you?
Yes.
Good, and you?
Good. Okay.
We, let me frame the discussion a little bit here. I got a call from John, and he says, hey, we think we need some of that sewer connections down in Clinton Street. And then at the same time I'm in the office and talking about that, I think it was Kobe says, well, they're looking at the Red House on Clinton Street of going through the septic design for that, and it's going to be expensive and hard. And at that time, I promised to get...
Is that the one right on the corner?
No, that's the Red House is right near the pond where the nursery school is.
Yeah, okay.
Daycare center is. And so anyway, I promised to get copies of what was in the master plan special permit and the host community agreement, which I think you all have copies in your package. And then we talked to Roy about it last week, and he's been contacting people, and all sorts of stuff have happened. And maybe, Roy, you can kind of tell us where we're at. And
sure. So I met with a few of the neighbors today. I believe I spoke to your attorney today also. No? Okay, so I thought you were, you're not Kathy Bartlett.
No.
Okay.
You talked with my wife.
Yes, I talked to your wife, but I also, Kathy Bartlett is the house at 26 Clinton.
The Red House.
The Red House. I had spoken to her attorney today. I sent him a copy of this information. It was very helpful because we had spoken, 6-9 months ago, and I had given the name of a contractor that she wanted to speak with, and I'm not so sure that went anywhere. So I met today with the Clark and Rybergs. And we discussed, we walked the situation from 6 Clinton Street down to where the current sewer exists. And after that meeting, asked for some information, so I went back to my office. We pulled together some cost information relative to what is the typical sewer bill for the average three-bedroom home. So we put that information together. I also spoke to DEP today just to check on the process, and that is in this email. I don't have...
They have
copies. Oh, you have copies, okay. So I checked with DEP, and a couple of things would have to be done. One, there would have to be an engineered plan design going from the sewer system to each individual home. That would have to be certified by an engineer, showing the grades, the contours, the pitch, the elevations, all that. It would then have to get approved by Hopkinton Board of Health. There would have to be an abandonment plan for the existing septic systems at the homes, because typically you have to empty the tanks, fill the tanks with sand or concrete or whatever the case may be. Once those two things are, the plan is approved for the dismantling or abandonment of the tank and approval by the Board of Health, then we would take those plans to DEP. DEP would then approve it, and then it could proceed. That's the process.
It's similar to the process the town went through when we created the sewer systems. I mean, DEP has got to approve every line and make sure the engineering is right. It's a pretty short line, so I don't think the engineering cost is...
No, I don't think it'd be too much. The other thing that DEP also told me is there would have to be an easement from where the sewer goes from the existing manhole. Whether if it's in the street, that would have to be an easement. If it's on the shoulder or if it's on private property, it would literally have to be an easement all the way to the point it enters the foundation.
Okay, that's different.
But yeah, that's different.
It's a private plant.
And so I queried that as to why is that? And they said, because if ever there's an issue, let's say there's a change in home ownership or whatever the case may be, that if there's a situation where the sewer line needs to be repaired, replaced, whatever the case may be, there needs to be a right to do that.
Okay.
In addition to the question I have for you is, we're looking at a 5-year window for anyone to tie in. Is that what I'm gathering?
5 years from whenever the beginning.
Whenever it is established.
Yeah.
So the tarring of the road, I mean, I know that a lot of times when you redo a road and you resurface it, you don't really want to break that open again and keep doing that, right? I mean, is that...
Well, that's true, but I think Clinton Street...
The gas company ripped it all up.
Yeah, apparently they're doing it again. I'm not quite sure why, but...
Yeah.
I mean, what would happen is the homes that are from, let's say, from Chris's house to the plant, there's already a sewer line on that road. Okay. So that would just require doing what's called laterals from the sewer line to particular homes. Beyond where Chris's house is, going up all the way East Main Street, there's nothing there. So that would require, whether it's cutting up the road or whatever the case may be, putting in a sewer line and probably some manholes, you know, because you can only go so far without a manhole.
So would we, they would be considered connecting boxes?
Well, they're transitional manholes.
Transitional manholes?
Yeah.
And would each house have to have one?
No.
Okay, and then would we wouldn't resurface until 5 years from now?
No. Well,
you probably should drop the word we.
Sorry about that.
Basically, the selectmen will, or the DPW will issue a road opening permit, and all those details get handled by the
selectmen. Those aren't a big detail.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean,
that's not our problem.
No.
What it really comes down to, frankly, is it's an individual decision on each homeowner as to whether they want to tie in.
Sure.
Now, if you have a perfectly functioning system,
yep,
it probably doesn't make sense to tie in because you're not going to be paying $1,300 a year in sewer fees. You're not going to be paying $686 a day you tie in. So, you know, there's thousands of dollars there if you've got a perfectly functioning system. If you have a failing system, and it's going to cost you $30,000, $40,000 to replace it, it does make sense to tie in.
Right.
And that's kind of the long and the short of it.
Right. And that's why I'm bringing it up, because I'm...
And there might be a... in the middle type situation too, at least from the town standpoint, we would require the laterals to be made to the property line when you did the construction. You know, one of the things that, depending on the economics, for Chris's house and the red house, where the line's there, it's just the lateral, and that's kind of it.
Right.
But the ones on the, I'll say that require several people's houses. Let's say the people on the west side of the street all decided they wanted it. The people on the east side said, oh, geez, we're okay right now.
Right now.
Well, then you get into a question of, I'm going to say fairness, as to who's paying for something that goes that way. And quite frankly, I think the neighborhood's got to sort that completely out.
Right.
But, you know, the town, when it did things, and I was sewer commissioner and started like five of the six phases, the town didn't worry about fairness. When the town meeting voted it, everyone was paying their betterment on that. And
I remember,
you know, the last ones, yeah, all of us, I paid $15,
but the town has that authority.
We have the authority. This is different in that this is an individual private transaction. What the planning board did when we set up the master plan special permit, we realized that there would be some places right around Legacy that, quite frankly, this is their best shot to get a public sewer. The probability of the town sending a line down in that area is
slim to none.
Well, in my lifetime, I don't think it's going to happen. But, you know, I think eventually it might get done. But I plan on living a lot of years, quite frankly.
Well, this is why I brought it up.
Yeah.
Was for that particular conversation. Was I was hoping that we had that dialogue where we say, you know, we, like Ken, you say, bring the box to the edge of the road.
Well, this might be a way where those people that don't need it today don't want to pay the
tie-in fee.
All the little things, but will participate in their share of the line that goes down the road.
Exactly.
And gets it out of the road and pay the capital costs kind of up front. And if things are there, I don't know whether that's an option that you know.
Maybe we
the
can
chair,
yeah.
If I may.
I frankly don't think we
have the floor.
Sure.
Sorry. But it's my understanding from this discussion is that it's a mixture of a private enterprise with some public good that can come from it. But not everyone is willing to participate in that, and they shouldn't be held to have to pay any sort of betterment. But if there's a plan that could put this in place with the developer, and in the future, if they want to tie in, they could pay in whatever that amount is, but I don't think anyone should have to pay anything if they don't want to.
Well, that's true, but future tie-ins are based on, you know, who do you pay the
piper now, or
who do you pay for the construction cost?
That's one that's
bettering you now. You can say no, but you make the no decision. I think it's a permanent no decision because the other folks, in fairness to the community, they've all paid more than their fair share.
Well,
I mean, that's, you know, that's the
it's a free market, and they have their choice. And
well, yeah, but no, no, but the I'm not saying they have to join, but they probably give up their rights to join if they give them up
forever.
You know, you got to make the investment if you want to be part of this private sewer system,
and that's why I'm bringing it up.
I actually agree with what you say, but I think, in some ways, we shouldn't get so much in the weeds here.
Mm-hmm.
I think the reality is, and we've discussed this with the neighbors, they should really, going from, what's the new called, Whispering Pine, wherever the street is, Winding something, Pulte's new little street there.
Wayside.
From Wayside to East Main Street, pick a number, if there's maybe 8 or 9 houses or something like that. Someone in the neighborhood should get together with all those neighbors and see if everybody wants to be a participant. If they do, then, you know, whatever the number is divided by 8 or 9 is a much smaller number than divided by 2 or 3. That makes a lot of sense to me. But frankly, it shouldn't be us or myself. It should be the neighbors who decide.
Absolutely.
That.
Right.
And if they want to do it, I'm more than happy to walk them through the process. But it really, that decision should be made first, because it's going to make it a decision on how big the pipe is going to be, how far it's going to go. As you go further up, the street goes higher. I mean, there's a lot of things that need to be looked at, but it's simple enough to do, but it has to be a choice.
But that's
for you, Mr. Chair.
To
the Chair's point, though, what if only 6 of those 9 want to participate? What happens with the other 3?
Well, if
they all vote.
If
forever?
They are,
or?
Well, you know, that's
subjective.
That's up to the 6 people that go ahead with it. If you're going to let them back in a future time, I don't care one way or the other, but basically the people that build the pipe today are putting out a reasonable amount of money.
Now, what might be an interesting concept to that idea, and I can talk to DEP about it, remember I said there needs to be an easement for that pipe?
Yeah.
Now, maybe that easement is owned by those neighbors that paid for it, and if someone else wants to tie in later, they got to go talk to those neighbors.
Yes, that sounds like a great idea.
I don't know if DEP will buy into that, but it's something worth looking at.
So just so I'm understanding this correctly, that is the big difference between the private establishment here versus agreement versus the public, because the public, they would have to pay.
Yes, right? Yeah. Yes. And whether you use it or not, right. You're paying.
Right, okay.
My neighborhood's paying about $800 a year for having the
mine was quite more than that.
Yeah, yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Question, Roy, I bounce this off you.
Just need a name and address for the record.
First name, Clark, last name, Waterfall, 7 Clinton. And it was just a clarification question. Who owns that pipe?
Which pipe?
The extension piece, not the two each house piece, but the piece that might either go to the edge or in the road. And who would own the maintenance of that pipe?
If that were owned by us, we would own. We being, see, there's a multiple of entities. There's Legacy Farms LLC, which owns all the property. There's Legacy Farms Landowner Association, which maintains and manages. There's a separate entity, a nonprofit entity, which is Legacy Farms Private Wastewater Treatment Facility LLC, which is what owns and controls and manages the sewer treatment plant. Now, we had to put a lot of money in escrow in the early stages of building that plant, and something of $200,000 to $800,000 is literally sitting in a savings account somewhere that grows every year, partially through the fees of the sewer use. And every time a new home connects to the system, they pay that $686, which immediately goes into that fund. The idea is over the next 20 years, that fund will probably be $2.5 million. So if something has to be replaced over time, whether it's equipment, fields, whatever, the money is sitting right there. That's a requirement of DEP.
If I may. It's just, and I'm guessing your questioning is when the town brings water to a house, they're responsible for everything outside the house itself. And then inside the house, the owners are responsible for that. Is that kind of the questioning that you're leading towards?
It's a bit of a chicken and the egg, though, because if we, let's say it costs $50,000 to put in the pipe.
Yep.
That's the purchase of the pipe, the digging, excavation, repaving, whatever else we're doing. In theory, then, those who paid for the pipe would own the pipe. But in this case, that just doesn't seem logical.
No, as to Roy's point, I think, and maybe I'm going off on this too far, but to Roy's point, if they're going to put in that pipe and they set a certain deadline, dead area where it ends, they would take care of that and maintain that.
I think, Cliff, I think you're missing the point. I think the question really is who's going to do the maintenance on the stuff that's out in the street? And which one of the LLCs does the maintenance, say, going down Legacy Road South?
The PWTF.
So basically, you're buying into that, so potentially,
correct,
you might be giving them the pipe at the end of the day.
Might
be a solution.
The normal way DEP would look at this, because I did have this conversation today, is we would own it right to the edge of the foundation, we being the entity. Now, once you connect to the entity, you actually become, for lack of a better term, a shareholder in the entity. You're actually a participant in the entity, as will everybody else that owns a home. So someday, when we turn over the entire facility to the entity, because everything will be built, there'll be a homeowners organization, there'll be a board of trustees for the plant. You could potentially be a trustee of the plant, or whomever. I mean, it'll be a vote of the homeowners. So it's a freestanding, perpetual entity that goes with the property.
Okay. Helpful. Just trying to understand.
Yeah. But again, I could talk to DEP and say, gee, by the way, we have this unique circumstance where X number of neighbors want to run their lines up a certain length of the street. Can they own that piece? Or if they don't own it, can they have easement rights on it? Which would preclude others from connecting unless they paid you being who have paid for it, a particular fee in the future. My guess is that probably could be worked out, but I'll check with DEP if that's the route everybody wants to go.
So, Mr. Chair, just so I understand, there's the planning board will not be making a decision tonight. This is just a discussion.
The planning board has done 90% of what it's going to do when it enabled this connection, foreseeing that this would might be a good thing for these streets. And at one point there was Linden and whatever, there was potential running the line right down the streets. Those people have basically opted out early on. So this is, you know, 29 folks that...
it's just a discussion.
It's just a discussion.
It's a private transaction.
It's a private transaction. We're kind of bringing people back together.
Advocacy.
And then you guys can make kind of whatever decision you want to make. We're just saying, as far as we're staying tonight, is we never envisioned that we're going to stand in the way. And Clinton Street was one of the named streets in our master plan special permit.
Excellent.
Connection. And quite frankly, there might have been a little foresight in that. But anyway, are there any questions from anyone else here?
I see someone.
Yeah, well, yeah. There's been a lot of discussion, you know, prior to my arriving tonight, so this was all one question. I really didn't digest anything that was in writing. You know, my main concern was, first of all, here we are, you know, does the zoning even allow this sort of thing, you know, the public to connect to a private facility?
This has been approved by DEP.
And it does. Okay. you know, and then, you know, one of my questions, and it sounds like you just answered it, was, is it the town's intent ever to, you know, accept the infrastructure and the wastewater treatment?
Oh, yeah. We'd love that. Do you want it tomorrow?
Well, it would make it easier on us.
I think there's a clause in there that says the town is not interested in it at all, ever.
Should I mean, that's seek another board's opinion?
Well, what if their fund gets really high?
Let's put it this way. It loses money every year, so if you want it, we're happy to give it to you.
Yeah, I mean, it's... This was part of the negotiations when that all went on. There was some discussions at one point of making it part of the town sewer system, and that ship has sailed.
Okay, well, that's fine. As you said, I'm kind of late to the table here.
Sure, no problem.
And
good question.
A lot of questions, and I guess some of you pulled up numbers here of typical.
I'm sorry, but I forget which house you live in.
I'm at the second house.
Right next door, brand new to the house. Oh, okay. We need your name and address for the record, man. Right. Oh, 4 Clinton Street. Your name? Ann McCobb. Thank you. Are you with the telephone booth? No. That's an excellent. She's more. I have the ledge. Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. Now I remember. That's significant piece of, you know, natural. That's called traffic calming. It sure is. Yes, exactly.
Because the two 20-mile-per-hour signs on either end of the nine homes doesn't
work. It actually is, Mr. Kistner, I think, another competitor to your donation to the Historical Society Rock. So this rock is slightly larger.
Slightly, yes. Yes, thank you.
Still historical value.
Right.
It's actually bigger than Plymouth Rock.
Right. Yeah. So
Plymouth Rock used to be bigger.
I guess... when I'll study this, I perhaps have some questions for you.
Sure.
I assume you pulled up some numbers that were average costs for people in existence in the new development now. Is that for
no, annual? That's right there.
It's yeah. all in here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, if you're using less bedrooms, your costs would be less.
So there's never any capacity issues? I know you've added to it.
No, in our DEP permit, it actually allocates for that.
That's future growth?
No, for these homes.
Oh, just for the homes.
It's already baked
there,
in.
Okay. So as far as anything futuristic, there isn't. There's no growth aspect to it.
I don't know what you mean by that.
The pipe size.
Well. No, the plant is designed for it. The fields are designed for it. It's accommodating for it.
Everybody on Clinton Street.
But I mean, there are 800 units going on the north side, so
right.
You know, ours is a rounding error at best, right?
That's correct. That's absolutely
not,
correct.
That's not miss.
We have already allocated for you if you want to use it. Let's put it that way.
If I add bedrooms?
Say again?
Or if you want to in the future, add
it's not going to. It's going to be inconsequential.
I would think so too.
Yeah. I mean, the most we're talking here is maybe 450 feet of pipe.
Right.
Yep. We're not talking, you know, 2 miles of pipe here. It's pretty small as far as prices go, it's a nothing.
You might get a rough estimate on what that number of pipe feet of pipe might cost, because the town has done some of that on Elm Street in the last couple of years.
Well, Roy's done, you know, all the south side.
Yeah, we gave you a ballpark idea.
Okay, so you've got a per foot, you know, cost.
Yeah.
He can do it cheaper than the town did.
I was just saying, if nothing else, you know, just the treatment plant happens to be on our street.
Yep.
And for me, I think it's the right thing to do.
They're failing. The fundamental problem is that there are failing systems on these houses.
Title V.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
And some of them on the even side are, I think, somewhat impacted by the building that went on behind them.
Yes.
The old age home, or whatever we're calling this.
You mean through vibration of the ground?
Yeah. No, actually, through land grading, regrading,
right.
And
yeah.
Water run.
I see.
That would take years.
Wetlands between them.
Yeah.
Just anyway. To bring us back, is the abandonment of the wells an expensive thing? Do you guys have...
No. You're talking about the tanks?
Yes.
Tanks,
no. It's short.
No.
Okay.
They pump them.
Fill them.
They take a jackhammer to the bottom so that they won't ever float, and they fill them with sand. And it takes the guy about half an hour to do it.
It's not a big deal.
I have a question.
Yep.
If people connect to town water, they can approve or deny changes in rates and capital projects for water at town meeting. Who has a say on the rates now for the private wastewater treatment plant? Is it just like the tenants or the users on Legacy Farm South and North, or would it be everyone that's a customer?
So just to give you an idea, we have an annual meeting every year with the homeowners, and the individual neighborhoods have homeowner association meetings. We have an annual meeting for what's called the Landowners Association, which includes the PWTF. And we give everybody complete financial accounting of everything, snow plowing bills, utility bills for the treatment plant, whatever the case may be. So when all the homeowners get to see the exact cost, I mean, someone brought up, gee, why are we paying for an internet connection in the PWTF? I said, because it's connected to the computers with GE in Canada, who can literally look at the plant from Canada on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
So things like that. So everything is transparent. We don't pick arbitrary numbers that, gee, we think we'll charge this for sewer. It's purely based on cost.
So it's reasonable to expect that the Clinton Street neighbors that sign onto this project would be members of the association, that they could attend these meetings. And
absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
They would be, in fact, members.
Excuse me.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's just most unusual that you need an easement for this entity, you know, right to my foundation. So is that
I don't need it. DEP is saying we should have
that,
it.
Isn't that what gives us the, you know, ability to belong to the homeowners association?
Yeah.
Just not so much the pipe. It's the fact that you're running a sewage into the plant. Now, I'd be happy if you all decided, gee, we're uncomfortable with you having an easement on our property, that we'd like to own it ourselves out to the street and to the manhole.
Mm-hmm.
I have no problem with that. DEP doesn't have a problem with that.
What is behind all this, and particularly it's on the water side right now, the water goes to the property line, but if you had a lead pipe, which Hopkinton does not have any of them, but say if you're in the town of New Bedford where there are a significant number of lead pipes still in service, the town can't go on your private property and remove the lead pipe. They can take the lead from the main out in the street to the property line, but they can't take that next section. And it's actually been proven that if you only do half of it, it's actually worse than if you'd done nothing at all. So basically, this is similar to it on the sewer line. The only real concern would be is what would happen if the pipe cracked or broke near your foundation and you were pouring lots and lots of groundwater into the sewer treatment plant, which raises the costs because of the infiltrated water. They want the ability to go in there and dig it up and fix it, regardless of what it is. And I think that's the DEP reason why they're asking to do that.
Now, the other thing I'd like to bring up is the pipe that's being used today, it's called Schedule 35 sewer pipe. It's very, very strong. The possibility of damage, the only way it's going to get damaged is if you physically damage it, hit it with a backhoe, do something like that. So that's not really an issue. I will say, though, if you do connect, the other thing I don't mention here is our office gets about 500 water bills readings a month from the town, because your sewer bill is based on your water bill, because it's the only way you know how much sewage you use. So we've told anybody who wants to connect, if they connect, if you have irrigation in your yard, you really should put that on a separate meter, because otherwise you're going to be paying a sewer charge for something that's not running through the sewer. So that's really it.
So anyway, I think we've talked about this, unless there's other questions.
So Clark has all my contact info, my card, my email, my cell phone. You can share it with whomever likes it. If anybody has any questions, they want me to send them anything, happy to do so.
Is there a line, a sewer line, next to 10 Clinton Street? I'm John Froome, 10 Clinton Street.
Thank you.
No. And I thought I saw them putting a line all the way through that.
That's a gas line.
That's a gas line. All the way up to the...
All the way to East Main Street.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It basically, it stopped and went to the back of the assisted living
into
area,
that village,
right,
into that village, and then that's where it kind of connected to it. But it's all gravity, so that's really kind of good news.
So you're talking the sewer system went down. What do we call the side street? What's this?
Wayside.
Connected to the development on the back side.
Yeah.
I know the gas line. But
The sewer goes back there too.
Sewer comes back down.
You can. The sewer line, if you look at it out there, it goes from manhole to manhole, and it's a straight line from manhole to manhole. And if you had to jog it to get it back out in the middle of the street, there's one manhole there, and if you're only 400 feet to the next manhole, there'll be one manhole at the other end, and that's probably all you would take to get that done. 400 to 500 feet is an okay distance for a manhole, unless they had to jog it in the street because they had to miss a water line or a gas line or something like that. But usually they can one jog to get it over there, which is one manhole, then straight down the street, unless there's, I don't remember a big bend in the street. It's straight there. So and that
drive way too fast.
Yeah.
John, you good?
That rock doesn't slow anybody down. Yeah.
Are you good?
The next house after the rock. And people are toasting by my house.
Okay.
Yeah, you can give me a call.
We'll do
that also.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Okay.
All
right,
good.
Well,
thank
you very
much.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Okay.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it. Hey, guys.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hey, good one. How are you doing?
Okay, we're running a little bit late, so let's...
Nice meeting you.
Roy, you're missing two people. You have seven ready.
I'll talk to you about the right side of the way.
No problem. Thank you.
Okay.
Redberg.
You have seven voting members here tonight. You want to continue?
I'd like to try.
Okay. Okay, we're going to reopen the continued public hearing for the application to amend Legacy Farms master plan special permit. This is to increase the number of dwelling units by 180 age-restricted units. I'd like to refer you to the outline that we've been using. And I think where we left it off, we're on 4C with an action item to maybe further define the traffic concerns. I think that was it David, your question on that? And
I don't think so.
Well, it was somebody. It was in their minutes. Somebody asked a question about...
I think it was Vincent.
Was it Vincent? Oh, okay.
About traffic?
Yep.
Yes.
So anyway, we have the action item going. And I think you have also a VHB letter here that kind of talks to some of this. But I think a lot of the questions, if I remember correctly, were kind of like how does age-restricted present a lot less traffic than a big office complex?
Well, yeah, my primary concern was that the people at the office complex are heading into town at the time where the age-restricted will be heading out, and I think their comments were something like, you know, there wouldn't be a significant amount of traffic. We've done a study, and that's what you come up with.
Well, if you look at page 2 of this handout from VHB, it shows the daily traffic, page 3, traffic flows of Legacy Park versus the current projected on the age-restricted. And then you get the peak hour, and then the peak hour in the PM and the AM. So the numbers are significantly less. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the reasons, so when we talk to Pulte, and we talk to Toll, and we talk to a number of other players in the marketplace, the average age moving into these age-restricted properties is 62 years old. Obviously, some are older, some are younger. When you really think about it over a 5 or 10 year cycle, these people are 67, 68, 70. These people are retiring. So, in fact, the amount of driving and going to work they're doing is, on a yearly basis, decreasing. And these numbers from VHB are really from the ASHTO tables, meaning these are standards that have been tested and proven. So we're very confident in the numbers.
And maybe if we're worried about the traffic being a little bit higher at the initial part of this and graying into the 4 or 5 years from now, the north side will be still being built out at that time, so there might be kind of a, you know, we're still under the traffic count that was projected, 10 years ago?
Yeah.
Well, originally, like I said, my concern was that coming into town, it doesn't seem to be as much traffic as going out at 8 o'clock in the morning, and that's when you said that the traffic would be significantly less because of the age-restricted, my feeling was that those people are in town heading out, and if you've ever been in this town at 8 o'clock in the morning, getting out of town is almost impossible versus coming in where the roads are fairly clear.
Yep.
So those people coming into this development, to the Legacy Park commercial, they wouldn't be really restricting traffic as much as the 800 or however many cars heading out at the same time. That was my only question at the time.
Yeah.
Was I felt like...
Did you just say that traffic coming into town is less than traffic going out of town?
At 8 o'clock in the morning it is.
As somebody who drives into town every morning at 8 o'clock in the morning, I beg to differ with that statement.
I know I live on 85, and going into the downtown of Hopkinton, I can't pull out
of Chamberlain Street. I sit on West Main Street for 10, 15 minutes at a time.
I will say this, though. I think just in sort of a 30,000 feet, the use of 180 age-restricted units, no matter how you slice it, coming or going, is significantly less than any kind of commercial use. So I think there should be comfort in that. And I think Ken says, as they gray in place, it's going to be even less so. So it's a nice thing to find that traffic's going to be going down sequentially over time as opposed to the other way around. So I think that's a positive feature.
I know when we did our walk, we went over to Halston Woods, and they told us that of the 24 sold, 22 were in the 55 to 60 range, so that they all were basically still working full time. Does that change the numbers at all that VHB?
No, but VHB has actually done that using that basis.
Mm-hmm. And is that assuming one car or two cars for each unit?
Oh, I'm sure.
I would assume two cars for each unit. Yeah. I mean, they're all going to have two-car garages that we saw.
Okay. Yeah.
They did.
Yeah.
So these numbers kind of take that in.
Yeah, two cars is typical.
Good job.
For this report, if I come into the chair, the age-restricted numbers make sense, but I'm looking at the 3070, and I think that it's kind of picking and choosing what numbers you want to show. I think the original point is that if there is an office building, commercial complex, that we're showing the most... almost an exaggerated amount of traffic compared to people just living there, two cars, 2 to 4 trips a day, whatever. And the only thing that's really good, maybe that could save the issue, is that if we have better management of traffic in town, and one of the ways we're doing that is with the new road.
No question about that.
Well, I, and your observation is absolutely correct. We with the master plan special permit stage, wanted a worst case analysis,
right,
so that we would know whether we needed traffic lights and everything else. So, yes, number one, you know, there's a question whether he actually can find a tenant that really wants 200,000 square feet with cube after cube after cube after cube after cube, but that is kind of what's baked into those numbers that we insisted that he used to be worst case early on, and I think we're seeing that traffic, even on the south side, is less than some of the worst case numbers that we've had. And in fact, East Main Street actually has less traffic than we were projecting.
We just
five
did
and 10 years ago.
We just did a traffic study on East Main and what were the other streets? Was it Hayden Row or
Grove Street?
And we're either at or below the projections from 10 years ago. So I feel good about that. I will tell you, because I come into Hopkinton almost every day, and you're right about traffic on 85. But I know when I come up, I can either fight the battle going into downtown, or if I'm coming from the other side, coming from Ashland, coming in, fighting it that way, I just cut right through Legacy now, even though it's not open yet. It saves me like 7 minutes.
You can do that.
Well, I've been known to inspect Legacy North Road.
Me too.
I mean, it just saves so much time.
Yeah.
Well, we want to open that soon.
Yeah.
I've checked it out at different times of day and night.
It's actually pretty up there, isn't it?
It is very, very pretty. I do have one question for you, Roy. And it has something to do with water runoff. I went up there the other
let's go down the outline here.
Okay. Well, I still think it.
I mean, we're not talking about the road. We're talking about the outline for.
So, do we want to check off traffic concerns, or?
I'm going to ask for a consensus on traffic.
Yeah, I mean,
okay.
The numbers.
Okay. Okay. I think the next item that's at there. Because we got through the bedroom restriction, one is maintaining affordability, and we had the deed rider, and we had a lot of information in last week's or last meeting's packet on that, including the deed rider that Massachusetts now has developed for that.
Can we talk about bedroom restrictions? Because I have a couple questions.
Okay.
Now that I've been to Hollis and Woods. And I went today, and some of the things you guys were noting last week, that the designs of those buildings, they get a lot of space and a lot of rooms and a little space, which is really nice. It feels much larger inside the buildings when you're in them instead of them. But that brings with it some questions, because I was in a two-bedroom unit, and it easily could have been a four- or five-bedroom unit, and I know we talked about this before already, but after looking at a unit that you wanted us to look at, I have further questions and further concerns about underage people. Not underage, but people, if the intent is to be over 55, how do they handle it in Holliston? Well, they have a rider that no one under 18 can be there for longer than 6 months. So there could be some impact to the school system, but it would only be for half the school year.
No, they can't use the school system.
Mm-hmm.
That's not what I was told.
No,
and,
no, but that,
in practice.
Forget Holliston. The deal we have in Hopkinton is far more stringent. In Hopkinton, if you get caught using the school system, it costs you $9,000.
For the unit or for the association, right. So it is somewhat more of a risk that could happen when we have the design. It's really nice, but it's really four or five bedrooms.
But it isn't, because something to qualify for a bedroom, it needs, number one, a window, number two, it needs a closet, and number three, it needs to be zoned and permitted for it.
Well, the unit I saw, that's the main unit there, just to throw this out there, is there's a master bedroom, there's a bedroom upstairs, and then there's an office, and the office has a closet outside the room. And then on the first floor when you come in, there's a little sitting room on the right, and that could easily have them put up a door, because it has a walk-in closet with two doors. That could be the fourth bedroom. Downstairs is a semi-finished room that's perfectly nice. That could be the fifth bedroom.
Through you, Mr. Chair, is there any solution for this, or are we just presenting abuse options?
I wouldn't feel comfortable calling what I saw today as a two-building, two-bedroom unit.
But, Frank, what's important to remember is when someone's buying a unit like that, they've most likely come from a larger home. They probably had two or three kids. The kids are grown up. They want to move into a nice space. But they want what's called adult-sized space, meaning the husband probably wants a home office or his man's room, if you will, and his wife probably wants a room or her space. So it's typical that you would have a two-bedroom where you'll have these ancillary rooms that they can use for other purposes that aren't bedrooms. Because, number one, the homeowners association in these developments are very strict on what you do. I mean, you can't have people living in your house without people knowing it. You're cheek and jowl in these developments, so you can see what's going on. So, number one, it would be a violation of the zoning bylaw. It would be a violation of your homeowners association. And it would be illegal. So we can paint all kinds of pictures of anyone doing something that's illegal, but the reality is it's not legal.
But what I'm saying is I don't feel comfortable calling that second floor room an office when a closet is right outside. It's a walk-in closet right outside that one door. And the sitting room on the first floor is a bedroom. It has a window, it has a closet, but doesn't have a door.
It's a private enough area away
from the rest of the house, though.
We have the same problem on the 700 units that we've approved for the non-age restricted on Legacy, and it seems to be working out pretty well at this point. I know the building department has turned down people trying to make bedrooms, mm-hmm. and trying to you can't do that permit wise.
Our school kids
on the south side have been meeting or exceeding or below expectations, so that's the proof in the pudding.
Frank, and that's very true. The other thing to keep in mind is we get the sewer bills every month for every unit. And if I showed you across the board of 450, 500 units, it doesn't vary more than about 4 or 5% per household, depending on how many bedrooms are being used. So the three bedroom homes have a sewer bill of X, the two bedroom homes a sewer bill of Y. So when you take an age restricted unit, DEP requirements for a typical house is 110 gallons per bedroom. But for age restricted, it's 75 gallons per bedroom because they tend to use less water than people who have a bunch of young kids taking baths every night. So it would be so easy for us to monitor all those units and say, let's say the average unit's using 3,000 gallons of water a month. And all of a sudden you get somebody using 4,000, 5,000. We could look into that and say, what's going on here? Something's going on here. So there's a number of checks and balances.
Okay, so if that's a checks and balance, using big data to sniff out any variations in water usage, whose responsibility is it to determine if the people just using extra water or if they have extra people living there?
Well, first question is, why are you using so much water?
If they're paying their water bill, they're...
Well, no, but we have the right to ask, it's a private sewer system that you're adding more to the system. 179 other folks, what's going on with you?
Yeah.
So my question is,
and frankly, we can ask the building department to look into it.
Whose responsibility is it? You would ask. You see an aberration in water use.
Well, we could report it to the building department. The building department could knock on the door and ask. I mean, they have the right to do that.
I guess my question, Mr. Chairman, if you would share, is who enforces that? Is it somebody within the association? Because maybe if Ken's my neighbor and I know he's got a kid, but I don't want to kind of snitch on him because Ken's a rough guy and might kind of take it out on me.
Well, first off, understand something. If you have a kid and you're putting in the school system, the first thing they ask is, where do you live?
All I know.
And if you live at, Peachtree Street, what 12 Peachtree, and they look at him and say, well, geez, that's an age-restricted development. You can't have children from there. And by the way, the Homeowners Association is responsible for a violation. Not the individual homeowner, but everybody.
Mm-hmm. So it's the association.
So, do I really want to pay $9,000 because you've kind of cut the rules? I'm not so sure I want to do that.
Well, to Fran's point, though, I mean, what if he's a college graduate, which at 55, you could easily have a kid graduate college, can't afford his loans, he's got a really low-paying job, he's living with mom and dad
now.
But do we care?
Well, that's the question. Is he's under the age limit, but he's not in the school system. Is that acceptable?
Well, you can live there up to 6 months.
That's it.
Yeah. And again, you can find anomalies for anything.
Absolutely.
You know, if your daughter got divorced and she's heartbroken, she stays for 6 months, is that going to happen? Probably.
Mm-hmm. No, well, my point was there's a six-month cutoff. At that point, yeah. The homeowners association will knock on the door and say they have to leave.
Well, look, if they're there for 6 months, 6.5 months, I mean, you can find these tiny, tiny anomalies any way you want to look. But the reality is if you look at 99% of the developments that have these things, these issues don't exist.
The rules.
Yeah. Well, if the person is quiet and doesn't, you know, play their music too loud, you know,
in the basement, they're fine.
Yeah.
You know.
But my point is through the chair is that I would like to see a design that shows if it's a 2-bedroom unit, there's 2 bedrooms. If there's an office with a closet right outside of it, and the decorations in the office. Look to me like a bedroom.
But one of the things we don't want to do, Frank, is have, you know, just have lack of creative storage space being in a closet. I mean, one thing you have to do when you pull a building permit, you have to certify that it's only 2 bedrooms, number one. So I can tell you, big companies like the Pulteys of the world, they're not going to take chances on playing games with something that's an extra bedroom. And when they sell it to someone, it's in the deed. It's actually in the deed in the home. I don't know if you've seen these homeowner association packages. They're about this thick, and it gives you all kinds of restrictions, the do's and don'ts and everything else. So, I mean, let's put it this way. That's a heck of a lot more restrictive than your average home in town that you think is a 2-bedroom that someone turns into a 4-bedroom. Much more restrictive.
So, one last time, my point is that if there's a room and a closet right outside of the room, and it's a walk-in closet, to me, that's pretty much a bedroom. And if there's going to be design that's not a bedroom, that means the closet wouldn't be anywhere near it.
But people like to have storage. I mean, when you're 55
sure,
years old, you have stuff.
I'd like to have the storage. Yeah. That's all. That's all my right, point. Right. I enjoyed my tour today. Very good staff there. And
did you like the product?
Very, very good quality. I like the adult high ceilings.
If you got to 55, you know, the affordable ones are selling for $177,000, provided your assets aren't too high. I mean, they're not, you know, to me it looked like a pretty good deal.
Great deal.
That's a great deal.
I like the solar panel farm right there. Very nice.
See again?
The solar panel farm.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're back to maintaining affordability of the deed rider. Did anyone have any questions? We are proposing to include that in our conditions to insist that the Massachusetts one or
the Department of Housing and Community Development model deed rider.
Yeah.
That's in here.
Be included. I believe it's in there. We'll get to that in a little bit.
Okay.
Are we ready to close out the deed rider one at this point?
And we have closed out traffic concerns, right?
Yes, we have. Community impacts and mitigation. I think we talked a little bit about this in the general overview. I think if I summarize it really quick, the community impacts are mostly on, I'll say, emergency services as more of the impact, but the mitigation besides the net revenue of $1.5 million is kind of the big one. There's also mitigation in the host community agreement for 3 payments to, I believe, the fire department or public services, safety services, and there's also a large payment for use, I believe, downtown and trails that the selectmen negotiated. So I think that's kind of where we're at. I guess the other mitigation might be is that it's less traffic than the existing option. Is there anyone have any more questions on that particular part of the outline? By the way, public, you guys are allowed to comment anytime too.
Just okay.
Yeah, please. You know, this is a.
I had a question about the traffic. I know
you said go right ahead. I should have made it clearer earlier.
Sorry.
Procedurally.
Yeah.
Yep. I'm just curious that, if the traffic becomes untenable or not. For example, our neighborhood is off of Cougar Road, and So we're kind of blocked in by whatever is happening on Wilson. I'm just curious what's our recourse, what happened.
Well,
it seems to be like we're going to, the traffic report that seemed to say we'll watch it and see what happens.
I think the two things we've talked about in the past is one is perhaps put the stop signs on Wilson Street instead of on Legacy Farms, so that it just encourage people to continue on Legacy Farms to keep going. And you know, once they stop, they might turn right. But with Google Maps and Waves these days, they're going to, electronically, they're going to send it wherever the best way is,
yeah.
Quite frankly. The other thing we looked at is potentially, what we're going to look at is maybe there'd be a no right turn lane from Legacy Farms north going westbound so that you couldn't turn right onto Wilson Street.
Right.
And, you know, the concern was maybe from there people cutting into the Ashland train station via Wilson Street, Howell Street, or whatever it
right.
is. And those are ones that, quite frankly, I think when we, the traffic engineers, as I remember it, basically said, we'll wait to see what really is there. And that's kind of
yeah.
how, you know, if it's a real problem, yeah, those are two solutions that we think we could
yeah.
can do to help.
Because I know we've already seen an increase in traffic since the south development coming down Wilson, there's definitely an increase in traffic. People cut through down Wilson.
I would suspect that might be to the use of Google Maps and Waves these days, if they're seeing the difference. And if you haven't gotten onto that technology, you'll save you a lot of time if you use it. I mean, I hate to say it, but I know I've used it a couple times in other towns where I had no clue where I was going, and I was going down a bunch of subdivision roads that I'm sure
yeah,
in the past I never would have got there. I'd have been
right.
stuck out
Lost.
In the traffic.
We see them in rush
yep.
hour.
Well, that's
yeah.
that's what I think you're saying.
Exactly.
Through the
right.
chair,
yeah.
to your point, there are a lot more people in town and that do cross through Wilson Street to avoid the downtown traffic.
Yeah.
And rightfully so, that's a way to go. But when North Road is open, that traffic will come off Wilson Street and still come your way, but not come, maybe not go all the way north of Wilson, they'll still, who knows.
Yeah.
It's all subjective.
Yeah, we're hoping that Legacy North takes the brunt of the traffic.
Wilson is such a small, windy road
yep.
that
yep.
it's slower traffic on there.
Yeah.
Like
right.
the new Legacy Road is a little more well-marked and faster.
And you bring up a valid point, because I will tell you, if I'm leaving Legacy, like the Western Nurseries, and I head towards town, the traffic is backed up to where Lucky Rock used to be.
Yeah.
So and once I finally get to Wilson, I take a right, because I don't want to fight that traffic all the way downtown. But when Legacy is open, I can zip right across that way and go right down to 85. I don't have to go down Wilson.
Sure.
So I think you're going to find a lot of that traffic that goes on Wilson is going to go right down 85.
I think she's on the other side of Wilson, so
it won't affect her,
but
yeah.
to your point, that part of Wilson is
yeah.
less.
It'll actually help
because yeah.
people won't keep going.
Right.
Yeah. The key is to get people in the mindset of just getting over to 85.
So how would that happen if the traffic were to that point? The neighborhood would have to say,
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
And then at that point, we and the selectmen would have to invoke that
no
right area.
Turn.
Look at options.
Well, to that point, I'd like to suggest we start with a four-way stop sign in that intersection.
What do we have there now?
Just Legacy and Rafferty.
Just Rafferty, really, because Legacy's not.
No, Legacy's a stop sign now.
Is there? Okay.
I'm not sure. Do we have the authority to put two more stop signs? I think that's the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah,
we suggest that just
I think you'd want to wait and see what the traffic flow
is.
Yeah.
Until you have the traffic
clear
flowing
numbers.
Through there, you don't really know what it's going to look like.
Yeah.
It's almost guaranteed, though.
I'll tell you, long term.
They should, to your point, remove the stop signs. Switch them around, basically, right?
I think you should put the stop signs on Wilson just
right,
carry
exactly.
the traffic right through.
Exactly.
Because
right.
if I keep driving, I'm not even going to think of it taking a
right.
Right.
Exactly. That's what should happen.
I agree.
We could send a letter suggesting that switch if people felt that.
Yes.
You'd be okay with that?
It'd be better.
I can't speak for everybody.
No, but I mean, you personally.
Yeah, some kind of control.
I would entertain a motion to send a letter to the Board of Selectmen suggesting that the
stop signs be switched.
Switch on Legacy and Wilson.
What's the
at the time of opening Legacy Farms Road, which is coming up close.
If you don't have a stop sign, how will you ever be able to get off of Wilson if they're flying through on Legacy?
It's true.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe there's another suggestion, too, is to speed limit that signage.
Town has no control of the speed
line. You have to go to the state to do
that.
You
got to go through the state.
There's no
signpost.
There's no speed posted on
that. I don't think we should complicate it. Yeah, there's a motion, right?
Okay. Yeah.
It's been seconded.
Not yet.
Second.
Who moved it, please?
No one moved.
I moved it.
Oh,
moved.
I
moved. Second.
I seconded.
All those in favor?
Well, discussion?
Yeah.
I think it's important to, just for the idea that you were just talking about, to have the four-way stop signs just to have traffic flow and stop when it's needed. Someone's coming on Wilson Street that live on Wilson Street and they're going that way. They're going to have people coming down Legacy Farm North Road, and it'd be just easier and safer if there's a four-way stop. It's a four-way intersection, and I just feel it's a safer recommendation to make than to have two stop signs.
Okay.
So I throw that out there as a friendly amendment.
I actually will jump on that because I think coming down off of Legacy North, people are going to be moving at a pretty good clip. It's downhill, goes right into Radford, get a pretty straight shot.
Yep.
And I don't see the downside of having a four-way stop sign there, but I'm open to the discussion on that.
I think if you make both suggestions to the selectmen subject to a traffic consultant's recommendation, you know, whether it's Beta or VHB or whomever.
Sounds good. Okay.
Well, let me back up my suggestion is that I live on Saddle Hill Road. It's a winding street like Wilson Street where people cut through from Westboro and Southboro over to 495, and a lot of out-of-town traffic at rush hour, and we have a four-way stop and at the end of our street, and people often don't stop there, so police are there to remind people to stop. So I like to, if my street's really small, we're talking about Wilson Street at that point is pretty wide, and the new road is pretty wide, so it's more of a risk. So let's just
To you, Mr. Chair, I don't think anybody would be against the four-way stop, and that would be an easy, straightforward way to go.
Maybe you want to switch the amendment to go to a four-way stop at that intersection?
Yes.
I would, Mr. Chairman, yes.
I
make a motion. And the other thing to add on to that is you've got potential dog walkers, right, for the short period, right? Isn't that moving? Are they moving at some point?
They're moving, yes.
Yeah.
Who knows when?
Who knows? But you still have walkers.
Yes.
People cross into the sidewalk in general.
Why don't we switch the motions to make it a four-way stop, and also to install a few more no parking signs on what is now Rafferty Road.
Agreed.
So a four-way stop at Wilson and Legacy Farms Road North?
Yes.
Do we want that contingent upon a traffic study, though?
Mm-hmm.
Well,
I
don't think
we should.
No,
you don't need a traffic study. Let's save some money. If you're going to go both ways, you don't need
do
any.
Do it.
Save some money.
All
right. So I move the additional motion to have additional.
Well, we're going to ignore the first motion.
The mover already accepted the friendly amendment, so.
Yeah.
Right.
Moved and seconded,
yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Okay, so the motion is to send a letter to the selectmen recommending four-way stops sign on Wilson and Legacy North, and additional
no parking
on Rafferty Road.
Yep.
All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. So we've kind of...
All right, traffic is closed again.
We step back and close. Yeah. Okay. So now I think we're in.
Now you're all set.
We're at compliance.
Is that okay with you?
Yeah. I was kind of thinking that it could be good to have, but you want to save money, you know, have a traffic consultant. I don't know about calm traffic. That's not my field.
Bottom line, it's going to get everybody slowing down, which is
going to be safer.
Yeah.
It's going to be safer.
Okay. Next item is compliance with the master plan special permit, including the host community agreement. And I believe you got copies of everything with that, and we are talking about changing the master plan special permit. I believe we heard that from Elaine that we're pretty much up to speed on the host community agreement, subject to a couple of delays because the road didn't get finished quite on time.
And they have an agreement with the select.
I think that'll be wrapped up this week.
Okay. And the other compliance with the master plan special permit, I think, is fine.
Yeah, no issue.
So anyway, that if I see a consensus of that, which I do, then we've kind of concluded the general discussion. We're looking for public comment and also discussion of the approval criteria. The approval criteria were outlined in Jennifer's memo, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And
page two.
On page two, there are six things that we need to find. One is that the master plan complies with the provisions of this article and the design guidelines. The master plan serves the purposes of the OSMID district as described. The impact to town, the development activity shown on the master plan is anticipated to be a benefit to the town. The major intersections and roadways providing access to the OSMID district will continue to operate at an acceptable level of service based on the anticipated impact to vehicular traffic from any previously approved uses within the OSMID district that will remain, plus all new proposed development within the district. That the master plan provides adequacy for the convenience and safety of vehicular and pedestrian movement within the OSMID district and in relationship to the streets, property, or improvements outside the district. And the master plan provides for the adequacy of methods for disposal of sewage, refuge, and other wastes, provision of utilities and methods for drainage, for surface water and seasonal flooding, if any, and the protection of water sources for the town. Any discussion on
yes,
that?
Yes, I have one. That brings me back to the question that I was going to ask Ken earlier. I mean, not Ken, Roy. I took a ride up Legacy North during that rainstorm that we just recently had, and I noticed one of the catch basins was filled to the max, I mean just full, and it wasn't dispersing. Even when it got, when the rain was subsiding, it was that way.
It's I'm meeting with a contractor up there tomorrow. It's on the punch list.
Okay.
He's got to clean it out. It got full of mud.
All right, because that was a big concern of mine.
Yeah. I'm aware of it.
All right, thanks.
8:30 tomorrow.
If I may, yeah, go ahead. May piggyback on his question, on an ongoing basis. Whose responsibility is it to?
We have an ongoing maintenance program where we clean the sewers and the manholes once a year.
Got it.
We've been doing that down at Legacy South also.
That will transfer a Legacy Road north and south when the town accepts it.
Then the town
will pick it up.
Correct.
Excellent.
So are we still on the item 5?
Yes, we are.
Yeah.
Keep going.
I was asked by a person that was concerned about wastewater for the 180 additional units, and I was pretty sure that this 180 additional units will still go through the wastewater treatment plant.
Correct.
So I don't know if I pointed it your way. I think you were still here then, and then she was going to talk to Elaine. So good. I said the right thing.
And I believe the right, also to add to that, is the wastewater that was projected for the industrial 200,000 square feet was in excess of what you might have had for the 180 units.
Correct.
That's okay. Another question I got from some neighbor that lives within that firewall is when the firewall, if the firewall is ever triggered, how does that impact them and the other people that are getting the blowback? And I had a chance to talk a little bit to the former chief, and I didn't get a chance to talk to the new chief about it. And they said they would be here tonight, but
where do they live?
I'm Cedar Street. And
Cedar Street.
Also people on Kroger Road.
Oh, 85. I
I have no idea what would happen in that direction.
That direction isn't protected by the firewall, right?
Right. But the Kruger Road neighbors also asked the same question, but I think they're outside of it. But still, I don't know the answer.
The answer is that they are outside of it, and a couple of the Kruger Road homes are actually in the thermal exclusion zone, which is not necessarily the best thing in the world to be. But the Board of Selectmen at their last meeting accepted the Planning Board's recommendation to look at creating the gas lantern system around the other two-thirds of the area, and also to look at building a barrier on Wilson Street to take care of the stone wall or other barrier to prevent that. So the selectmen did vote that, I think, two meetings ago for them. So they've got the action to look at both of those things.
But in some ways, I would argue, because of that arc, maybe you change the arc on the left side of Legacy as you drive in, the lights.
It might protect a couple of homes on Kruger, but I don't think most of Kruger is protected. That's my opinion.
Okay.
I mean, the question
that was put to me was, doesn't that make it worse for the people that are already there?
No. It actually makes it better. Because
otherwise
it would ignite at their house as opposed to ignite potentially there.
You talking about the non-covered people?
The people that live on Cedar Street, closest to the gas tanks.
So they're not covered.
And the log cutting place on Wilson Street, and then the homes that are around the log cutting place.
Smith.
Have concerns, but...
Because they're all non-covered, if I understand correctly, and there would be
well,
no difference
the
than
Wilson,
today.
The Wilson, right. The Wilson Street one gets some coverage because we have a gas light right at Wilson Street and Curve Street. So that provides, I'll say, more coverage.
It's definitely improvement for all of those, but it's not perfect because there are gaps that at some point need to be filled.
And that's what the selectmen need to look at to fill in some of these gaps. But you might remember
the
test
company.
It would be great if the gas company fulfilled their responsibility, and nobody is saying that. Quite frankly, they should do it. And if they had any sense of morality and public safety, they would do something. But they don't. Bottom line, in the very low event that this thing might happen, somebody's vehicle, somebody's cell phone, somebody's whatever electricity in the house will most likely trigger it really quick. So it's much better to trigger it, in this board's opinion, on a series of gas lights
the question,
away from the houses.
The question that I was asked is, and this plan, and I have no answer, as plain as it can be, is the triggering it could be worse for the people that live
there. There'd be no worse.
You don't know.
That's what you're hearing.
But the consultants all said it goes back to the source. If you don't trigger it there, those houses will trigger it.
Yeah.
But here's what I'm asking for. The specific neighbors that asked me that aren't here need a scientific answer. And it's not your responsibility.
I'd be happy to talk to them and just get us together, and we will be happy to
talk. The report is also public information, so we can...
I can explain it to them in a lot of, I think, detail, and having spent a lot of time with the consultants. And, you know, this is, for some of those people, as the selectmen make decisions as to where they might extend our scenic walk with beautiful gas lights, it would be good for those people that have concerns to express those concerns to the selectmen. I mean, it's...
But remember, once it's ignited, it is...
once the spill happens that causes something major like that, it's all over with.
Right.
I mean...
It doesn't matter where you live.
It doesn't matter where you live.
Well, it does matter a little bit where you live, but I mean, it's if
you think,
you know, it's something we hope never happens.
Right.
It's a low probability event, but you can take, I think, some logical steps to make it safer for people downwind.
I mean, bottom line is it's safer now. It will
it
be safer,
safer than it was before.
Is.
Right.
Yep.
But we don't know that.
No,
for the question that's been asked, we don't know.
Yeah,
the
we do.
Yet.
No,
the
no.
expert that was here said
yes.
That it was an expert here.
So I want to see. I want to see a specific answer. I've been asked as an elected official. I've been asked.
And
how
my
does this make
is,
my property more dangerous or less dangerous? And
I will be happy to meet with each one
of
the people individually to set up the meeting. I'm usually available. And while I am not as good as the experts that we had in the town hired, I did work in that industry. I do understand the reports in great detail. And, you know, if worse comes to worse, the chief sat in with most of them with it. The, between the two of us, we could tag team those questions.
Because partly I was slow in getting back to them in email, and that's my bad. But I would appreciate it that if I would like to do that with you, and if you
sure.
do too, Chief.
We set up a meeting, and I'm sure I'm well, and the chief is nodding. And,
right.
And,
thank
you.
You.
Because yes, those are legitimate questions,
right.
And but I think there are very good factual answers for it,
which would be appreciated. Thank you.
And
through you, Mr. Chair,
yes.
I think in summary is the people that are covered will be safer. You have to feel comfortable telling this, but you should tell them that also the selectmen are looking at doing...
Tell them on there.
Yeah.
Well, I'm telling you because you're looking for a response to the people that the selectmen are researching doing the entire thing to make it safe for the entire circle.
Okay.
We're working on it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's continue on the public approval criteria. Were there any questions on the six criteria and whether or not any part of this did not meet those six criteria? They're listed on page 2 of Jennifer's menu.
I say we covered it.
I'm looking at a consensus that we've got that one checked off.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
Because you're going to be asked to vote eventually that we meet those criteria. And we also are taking public comment, too.
I might just ask a question, and I think it's covered, but it just might help me. As part of the host community agreement, again, Steve Slavenbarkey.
Yep.
My understanding is that there's the three payments of $120,000 set aside for public safety personnel. I believe it's going to be two firefighters speaking with the town manager. So just one of the pieces for me trying to keep the flow going with the construction is I just finished hiring the two from last year's town meeting. It took me, and with a great lot of help from human resources, about 9 months to complete the process. And I know at the end you run up against a kind of a window, I think it's the fall of 2018, that it just says, okay, if we haven't gotten a couple of milestones of the $120,000, that it would just be kind of a lump sum payment. What I'm kind of wondering inside of that is just part of servicing everybody, giving you inspections, servicing the community with a greater volume, if there's a way we can kind of have conversations about the flow and maybe the anticipation of some spending, and then I might talk with the board or the public about gaps in filling it so that we can get the services so we're not just all of a sudden 2018 trying to handle capacity that's just walloping us, and it would...
I'd be more than happy to set up a meeting with you.
Great. And all of this looks like it's mitigated. I appreciate it. It's almost as clarity for me, so thank you.
Great.
And I believe those payments are one of the paragraphs that are in the host community agreement that we actually reference in our proposed changes, which I think is about to segue me into the next topic if everyone is happy with the approval criteria, which I sense is.
Is this discussion about what the approval criteria are? Or
The approval criteria are set up in the bylaw.
Okay. Okay.
So we have those
so
six.
Whether it's been met in this hearing.
Those six are the approval criteria that we're supposed to use
okay.
in finding for that. Okay. And those are the six that I read off, which are.
Okay. So your question is basically, have all the approval criteria been satisfied in this hearing?
Right.
Okay.
And that's. I'm sensing from the board members that they're feeling fairly comfortable with it.
Okay.
And
I just
but you're allowed to make comments,
okay.
too.
I have a comment about use of the fertilizers, and I've written to the board several times about this, about fertilizers and glyphosate and the landscaping chemicals that would be used on this area since it's a large piece of land next to the sensitive areas of the Ashland wellheads and the reservoir and State Park and the conservation land and the neighborhood wells.
We actually have restrictions from CONCOM and from the planning board relative to use of particular types of chemicals given the fact that we're in a watershed area.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting. What are the restrictions?
I don't have them with me, but I can get them for you.
I'd be interested to know.
Okay.
Yeah.
And also, that's something we usually pick up more on the site plan review.
Okay.
I mean, and this is kind of the zoning enabling,
okay.
then they go off and design it, and we might try to make sure that it kind of meets the overall
okay.
possible. But you know, this is a key part because this kind of approves it such that he goes off and tries to sell the land for 180 units and or less, and then they try to design it to fit them in. Okay, so I think we're down to. Let's check off five. Number six, discuss conditions of approval and changes in the master plan special permit. That is a page that Jennifer handed out today and sent the board members an email last
Thursday late.
Yep. We meaning Jennifer, Roy, Ray via the phone when we needed him, I believe. Or
I talked to him earlier.
You talked to him earlier. Basically, these are all words that basically a town council has blessed.
Correct.
And you've seen for the last 3 months variations of this. I think the latest ones really had to do with the following changes. We took and made a small change to the last half of paragraph two, and that basically required that no more than 9 certificates of occupancy were issued for that in excess of the number restricted to. Anyway, that whole paragraph got changed to talk about that they would be made available for sale, I believe, as opposed to sold. And that compromise was a key one for Roy and Roy and the lawyers on that aspect of it.
Mr. Chair, question?
Yeah.
Clarity?
Sure.
So these here are for the OSMUD, which would include Legacy Farms South, Legacy Farms North, and the age restricted.
Correct. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. And this replaces different paragraphs, I believe.
Yeah, so these 2, 3, and 4 are already existing in the master plan special permit. This is new versions of 2, 3, and 4 that relate to this project. 13A and 74A are completely new.
So basically the first three are remove and replace.
Correct.
And then 4 and 5 are the last two are that way. The other changes that we kind of made is in item 4, the OSMID, that where it says 70,000 square feet, that's what's currently in the master plan special permit. We left that. At one point there was a bunch of ones going around with 40, but we changed the word to be commercial or retail as opposed to just retail. And then on 13A, between what people have seen for weeks, it's only the exterior finishes of the affordable units are the same as the market rate units.
Mm-hmm.
As I think everyone that took the tour realized that you got a little bit better appliances and you got granite countertops instead of formica in the market rate ones as opposed to the other ones in the Pulte development that you happened to tour. I saw the same thing in the Pulte development in Acton. But from exterior, you're not going to, other than your neighbor will be envious that you got yours for like $177,000 and you paid close to $500,000, $600,000.
That's roughly a third of the price, right?
Right. And you also make a lot less money than they, your neighbor does too. If you're getting it for $177,000,
yes,
an FYI.
You can't sell
sticking up for the little guy.
Yeah, and you have less in the bank too. There are some income restrictions too, and you pay less in property taxes because the property taxes are based on what the unit can be sold for.
But your house doesn't stand out like an elephant in the room.
That's correct.
You shouldn't be able to drive down the street and tell which ones are.
You will not know.
Right.
And,
You don't know.
We in the planning board will know because we'll have to permit each one of those and we'll say, yeah, that's the no.
That's the lucky guy.
Yeah, that's the people.
And so then the last one, Ken?
And the last one for 74A, basically, in between the last line in section 2, which the applicant will comply with sections 5A, 6A, or A6, I'm sorry, A5, A6, A7 of the host community agreement as recently amended on that date.
I have that as A3, A4, A8.
Right, that's on the last one. So that covers all the relevant sections of the host community agreement that makes payments to the town as mitigation. So that is... even with the way this is written, if the selectmen, for some stupid reason, would want to reduce that amount, they can't. I don't think they would do that, but it is some belt and suspenders to keep the agreement as Roy and the town agreed to earlier. So that's what we're proposing now for wording changes to the master plan special permit. Are there any comments on that, or are there any more public comments on everything else? And basically, at this point, are you thinking about being ready for a vote tonight? Because if there isn't, and if you're not ready for a vote, let's try to get to see what might
be in the way,
if there is, because I think we... Frank?
For me, it would be meeting with the chief and yourself, with the neighbors that are concerned about not this necessarily, but the...
We'll be happy to meet with them, but I don't think it applies to here.
Well, it does in a way that this project shouldn't make anyone, any of the butters, feel more at risk.
Well, the gas lights were part of what we approved on the north side.
Right.
So
sure.
They're already there. That's a given.
But
that's a given.
These are additional people living, within that area too. So I would feel better and feel more educated and able to vote on this. That's the last piece of the puzzle for me.
And if I may, through the chair.
And I think I want to approach it, for those of us who were in the meeting with the Board of Selectmen, we had a member quit over not having openness on this. So for me, I would like to have this be resolved and explained to the neighbors and myself. For my being able to vote on something that could affect other people's lives.
Well, first of all, I don't think this has anything to do with it because
right.
This Sentinel line of gas lights is already
mm-hmm.
written. Roy's actually even bought the lights is working to install them, because he's got some deadlines that he's got to have them in place before occupancy permits. So that part's going on.
That's here. A betterment. That is independent. Making things better.
I'm just telling you, this is okay. The last piece of the puzzle for me.
I understand. Okay. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. And that's good.
I'm just concerned that we've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars on consultants. I think we've come to a conclusion we all agree is making the neighborhood safer, not less safe.
We don't all agree on that, because we don't all know.
Again, we have the world's best consultants working on this thing. And my concern is, I don't want to hold this vote hostage to something that really has no bearing on it.
But we did hold this meeting off from last meeting, because we didn't have enough members. So here's a member who has, I think, I have a valid question, and
I understand that.
I don't think we held it off last week, because we had all these line items to go through. We weren't ready for a vote.
No, we didn't talk about it last week because we didn't have enough people in the room for a vote.
2 weeks ago, anyway.
It's not an unknown, unforeseen thing to be ready to vote and have people ready to vote. I'm here, and I'm saying I need just this one piece of the puzzle.
But isn't that what Ken and Chief said that they would entertain and follow through? So
let's do that, and then I'll be ready to vote.
Mr. Chair, could you do a straw poll to see if he has 6 votes?
Are you ready to vote affirmative?
I think that's just cherry picking when you want to have the vote, and there's a valid concern and question from members of the public to an elected official that I cannot answer. And I'd like to be able to have the expertise of the chief and the chairman of the planning board who have offered to do this. So if you're going to push to have a vote and you want to have a straw poll if you're going to win or lose, I don't think that's very transparent. I think there's information that needs to be conveyed to the abutters who have asked for
Frank,
an answer.
The real question is, the Sentinel line of gas lights, which might be concerned of making it worse for them, it's already been approved by this board.
Sure.
And it's going on.
But
so our meeting is not going to change anything that has to do with these 880 units. They have good legitimate questions and concerns, and I respect that. However, it's not germane to this particular discussion.
Point is that it is germane, because these 180 additional units are close enough to be a concern already, and there are neighbors that have concerns about the response there, these new units being that close, and the safety features that we've already approved, and I don't feel that we should vote on future on this yet until this part that's been asked tonight is answered, and it's I don't think it's a big ask.
I just also want to remind you that you will be reviewing the site plan review with the design, the location, and all of that, which I think would be more germane discussion at that time. This is strictly the change to the master plan special permit. So I'm wondering if their concerns are more suited for that conversation.
Another point of clarity here, but the expert has approved that these 180 people are within the buffer zone and will be safe. So, I mean, these 180 people
are outside the exclusion zone.
Yeah, but they're the reason we have the safety feature planned. And they're closer than everyone else in the north of Legacy Farm. There's a safety issue.
It's not the reason, though.
It's been asked. I don't see problem having an answer.
Frank, the question you're asking is about the people that are not part of the buffer zone. So now you're trying to include people that are part of the buffer zone? Your question was about the neighbors on her street, right?
There are neighbors on Kruger Street, neighbors on Cedar Street, neighbors on Wilson Street that have asked a specific question. What happens when this does fire back? Does it put us more at risk? And if there is an answer that they're not at risk, let's talk about it with them. The chief is open to it, and Ken is open to it. I would like to have this question answered before I can vote on it.
My offer is, and I said this in the hearing that you did up at the elementary school when the expert was there, is the expert truly had more talent and education in the answering the question of some of the examples that you're looking for and you're touching on right now, I won't be able to add more to what the expert said. And I said that in that statement. He clearly had the upper hand.
Correct.
On what he could do with his explanations to ignition sources, travel, distances of flow, when, and I think they answered him pretty thoroughly.
I would say, other than the experts themselves, no one has more knowledge on this than Ken.
Right, and I agree with that.
Well, I'm okay with if.
I just don't want to give you a false hope that I'm going to offer something new to you.
I feel better that if you're being there. I've spoken to Chief Urban about it. I've spoken to you about it briefly. But these are questions that I can't answer.
Sure.
And not being able to answer them, I'm not comfortable voting. And I don't think any of you guys can answer the same question, maybe except for Ken, to the people who have asked it. So let's answer a question.
We answered that question, in my opinion, when we voted to change the buildable areas. That's exactly what we did. When we changed the buildable areas on the north side.
That was the criteria of the change.
Right. And that was the criteria for that change. And so we did not create any buildable areas that were considered to be unsafe due to a potential accident.
But I've been asked, as an elected official, how does this affect my property?
I don't have
an answer that I can...
What we've said is we'd be happy to meet with them. It is not, in my opinion, germane to the vote today because it doesn't change any of the circumstances from that.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
My concern is you had a public hearing upon which we made a decision where all these issues were discussed and public was welcome to come. And if they had come, their questions would have been answered.
Yeah.
I have a concern where we have an issue that's a public hearing, everything discussed, public had plenty of time to ask questions and follow up, and now you have public who at that point didn't participate for whatever reason, good or bad, and is now coming back, and on an unrelated issue, we hold it up because they didn't participate when they had the opportunity. I think we're opening up a door here which I don't think we want to open up because we did, the experts were there, the public hearing was there, they were invited to come, all these issues were addressed, and now we're trying to go back and say, well, they missed the opportunity, they weren't there, they still have these questions. What's going to happen is this is now going to let us open the door that any time we have a question where somebody missed the public hearing and the actual participation of it, they can stop anything related to peripheral issues. And I think that's a very dangerous situation.
So summarize, you're afraid to set a, you don't want to set a bad precedent.
I don't want to set a, right. We had a public hearing over multiple days where the public was invited, where this issue was addressed and it was discussed. And based upon that, we made a decision and implemented a decision. If they had the question, which was their situation hasn't changed.
That was
the opportunity at that time to ask the question. Now, because they didn't take the time at that point to come to the public hearing, and peripheral approval is being delayed because when they had the opportunity to ask the question, for whatever reason, they didn't ask it. And I just really have problems where if we're going back and reopening things and asking questions because people at the time didn't take their time to be present.
So if I may address that, not everyone gets to every meeting, even on our board. Not everyone understands how town boards work, and not everyone has the ability to get to meetings. That said, I wish I'm partly responsible for maybe not reminding them to come tonight in soon enough time. If a person asks a question, and they ask this, not only one person, but three people asked me this, I don't have an answer, so I said I will ask, and I should have probably talked to you guys before. But I thought it would be better if they brought it up themselves. I feel as a member of this board that it's a valid question, and I think to answer it, that the suggestion and the offer by the chairman and the chief to meet with the concerned, so they can understand that the from their perspective, the abutters' perspective of what their concerns are, and the 180, how it ties into the issue is 180 additional units are the most at risk, and that's why there's this fire dam that's been
designed.
Don't
agree with that statement.
No, yeah, I don't agree
with
that statement either.
Statement.
At all.
And my point is that if there is another or better solution that it could be addressed to have the people that would be negatively affected by a solution for houses that don't even exist yet. And I think the people that have asked the question deserve an answer, and I don't have the information or ability to convey the information to them.
If
and
I,
Ken feels he does, and I would appreciate the chief being there, and I don't see a
through
problem
you, Mr. Chair,
in answering
is,
a question that's on our list of things that we're covering.
Through you, Mr. Chair, this
yeah.
is, not to be sarcastic, but this is like judging, approving Maspinock Woods related to the fire lamps. They're just two different things. I don't
no.
question that there's some concern and some work that needs to be done there, but it's just, it's not related to this.
Should I try one more time?
I don't think you should.
No, I don't think you should.
Well, you guys are talking without even talking to the chair, and you're not
no.
even listening.
I asked
no. So
the
don't
chair.
Listen.
It's
but, you know, people have asked a question, and I think they deserve an answer. I'm
I
not
agree.
Ready to vote.
Okay.
And I'm asking you guys, we put this off before because we didn't have voting members. Now here's a voting member with a valid question that I would like answered, and I don't feel that there's an answer ready to be presented, and I don't feel ready to vote.
I think the answer to the question for the vote tonight is these 180 units are an area that we voted is buildable land that is outside the safety concerns of where a gas accident could happen. None of these units are in a buildable area that is within the thermal exclusion zone or the gas exclusion zone when modified by our Sentinel lights. The gas will go elsewhere if there are no central lights, Sentinel lights. It will go to where it's going to go today if that accident were to happen today. So they are no better or worse than where
that's
where
my
they
point.
Are.
The Sentinel light being there could make it worse for the people
it's under a different project,
but it protects this project we're talking about. And
it doesn't.
Abutters have asked a question,
does
and
not
I
make
would like
it, worse.
It answered. I don't have an answer.
I know you don't have an answer because you obviously didn't listen to the testimony when we had the fire, or all the people here. I mean, the bottom
line.
That's
not very fair.
Well,
you were there, Frank.
Three,
Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
Frank, I think if you had a valid point, there's a very respectable board here, and at least one person would agree with you. You're out on a limb, and you're trying to explain the same thing over and over and over again, but there's 2, 4, 6 of us.
My point is valid, and my point is that I'm not ready to vote
okay.
on this based on I would like to have this last piece of the puzzle answered, and I don't see it being a problem asking that we have this resolved before move on a vote.
Well, first of all, number one, I don't think it's germane, it's been mentioned by several folks, to this decision tonight. Number two, I think you, as a board member, have a responsibility to bring these things to, I'll say, either leadership or to Jennifer in a timely manner so we can resolve these type of issues in between the board. What we're talking about, or have at least the people here so that we could talk to them.
Sure.
Without doing that, I don't think you met kind of your responsibilities when you have three people that have valid questions, not necessarily germane to what we're doing here, but valid questions. And, you know, we as town officials, all of us want to get answers to valid questions and safety concerns. We have no problem at all with that. However, it does not reflect on these units. As you might know, we struggled a long time, and until we got the LNG experts to say that, I wouldn't let you vote on where what was safe and was not. And we held that vote off for like 6 months, maybe even longer. And Roy is, you know, probably simmering during all that particular point. But we held it off because we felt we had a responsibility to make sure that we had something that was safe for these 180 units or safe for the 200,000 and all the office workers that currently could be working in that same spot. And quite frankly, if you're worried about evacuation, there's less traffic and less people on these 180 units than there might be with the 200,000. So, I mean, if you, you know, it is a probably a better situation from this standpoint.
So apparently when I said this earlier, you might have missed why I brought it up. Between our last meeting and this meeting, I was asked, and again, I don't have an answer. I should have made more of an effort to talk to the chief, and I should have talked to you. You're right.
Or to Jennifer.
I was under the understanding that the people would come here and ask the question, because it is a valid question. I don't have an answer, and that is, it's a fair question. What happens when the blowback comes back to the people that live on Wilson Street, that live on Cedar Street, right next to the gas company? Does it make it worse for them? And I don't think I can say it doesn't make it worse for them. Well, and I would like someone to answer this question. And you guys have offered to do it. And
right.
I think that offer is sure. Very generous. And I would like that to happen. And I don't see a question asking the board to let's get this answered.
Okay.
Because what if we go there and talk to them and they have other questions that make sense?
Okay. I think what I'm seeing is the majority of the board is ready for a vote. First motion I'd entertain would be a motion that finds that the board determines that the master plan as amended will meet the criteria in section B, and this is 1 through 6. Is that the first motion, Jennifer?
That's correct.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion. Seeing none, I
will just make a point that previously the board put off discussion on this because there were enough voting members that would be able to. There were enough voting members, but you didn't think there'd be enough voting members that could approve it. And we put off the meeting. I'm just asking for putting off this so we get further information. So your point right now is that we're discussing does it meet this? And I'm just babbling at this point, but I'm just very unhappy that we're not moving. We move for one thing, but not for another.
But there is no, through the chair, but there is no prudence of people being here, one. Two, it's you advocating for them, which was already stipulated at previous meetings by professionals that this topic was redundantly put into the ground over and over again. And now you've got three households that you say are concerned, but they're not here. And this is not a final decision made about the safety of that aspect. It's about, does this conform to the master plan? That's what we're asking and answering.
Yeah, go ahead.
We voted on this in July. We're now in October. So all these questions are legitimate questions.
Absolutely.
That were presented and discussed at a public hearing, and we voted unanimously.
I believe I didn't pull it up, but I believe it was unanimous.
In July. And now, because somebody missed the opportunity at that point, after 3-4 months, to go back and revisit it as a part of a peripherally related item, and my understanding was the discussion that Ken and the chief were willing to have was an explanation point of how it would work as opposed to opening up the issue again.
It was 9-0, you know,
so everyone on this eight.
Somebody was not here. No, it was 9. I'm sorry. Nine.
Was it 9 or was it 8?
It was 9. It was 9-0.
Okay.
And to answer your concern, John, since then I've been asked a question that I don't have an answer for.
Okay.
It's a very good question. It's a valid question. And if I was in a butter and this board approved
then you would
something
show up
without
at the
having.
Through the chair.
You know what?
Okay.
Not everyone can make every meeting.
No,
okay.
Not everybody being meets down
and,
hall.
And your chairman has offered to meet with them.
And I appreciate
them.
That.
And I would have met with them earlier this week if I would have known about it, and or last week, or whenever they call. Anyway, I think we've got a motion on the floor. I think
seconded.
We're ready for a vote. It's already been moved and seconded, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I think you're ready for a vote. This is a vote to determine that the master plan changes comply with the criteria from the zoning bylaw. This is in Section D, and it's subparagraphs 1-6. All those in favor of finding that it complies with that, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Abstaining.
And one abstention. Okay. The next vote I think we need to do is to...
And I'll say that my abstention is a protest of not having further information that's been asked for.
And then the second vote part of this is to amend the master plan special permit with the replacing paragraphs 2, 3, and 4 and adding new paragraphs 13A and 74A. So entertain such a motion.
So moved.
So moved.
And second?
Second.
We got moved and second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Let's see. We're looking for a motion to close the public hearing.
I move. So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Moved and second. This is to close the public hearing. All those in favor,
discussion.
Say aye. Oh, go ahead.
If there is this meeting, I hope, and there is this meeting, and there's information that shows that maybe the neighbors are at risk, would it be prudent to leave this hearing open, or would we need to open a new hearing?
We would do a new agenda item for that, and I'd be more than happy to do that anytime. And also, the selectmen are actually working on the real piece of the puzzle that would extend the shield to other parts of the town, and I'm sure they will probably discuss it at a time or two before.
And through you, Mr. Chair.
And I'm sure the selectmen will ask the chief's opinion, because they always do on that, and they might even ask my opinion again.
Through you, Mr. Chair, I think I can speak for the rest of the board that we'd all be willing to discuss this as a separate line item.
Sure. Yep. Okay. So the motion is to close the public hearing. How do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, now we're on a few other things. And Mr. McDowell, please stay seated because we got a couple other ones.
Sure. Legacy South?
Legacy South. I believe we have a request to extend it to May 1st, 2017.
We actually asked if we could get it till September 30th. So we've requested actually through Jennifer to get the name of the consultant at Weston and Sampson we'll be using, because we'd like to engage, you'll be engaging them
mm-hmm.
to do a complete walkthrough punch list with us.
This is September 30th of next year?
Yes.
Curves and everything.
Can I ask where that paper
resides.
There was no paper.
Oh, that's why. Okay. Yep.
I thought, through Mr. Chair, I remember something about moving this to the spring. Is that what we're talking about?
Well, we're going to start at the spring.
I remember from last...
No, but the extension, right?
We just talked about it.
Are we talking about moving the extension?
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, I thought it was proposed
Currently, the subdivision plan had a five-year limit, which is expiring.
Right, and I did read that.
And you read that in Jennifer's memo.
It's in my memo.
Yes.
And basically, we're not going to meet October. No way, no how. And what that really means is Roy's going to have to plow it for another year. Maybe two, I guess.
So what is the proposal?
We saved the town $75,000 by doing that.
Okay. Well, whatever.
So you want to extend it for five years?
No.
We have it. So yes.
Right after September 30th would be great.
So I guess the request is to extend it to September 30th, 2017. That basically says for sure it doesn't meet next May's town meeting.
I move.
Get it all done by
I make
but,
a motion.
But if he does get it done in a reasonable time, you know, maybe the spring is different or somehow and things.
I mean, look, if that's possible, we have you do it, but I just don't want to have to come back. So I'd rather if you could give us September 30th, if we get it done quicker, great.
Discussion.
Yes, go ahead.
So just describe the process. What has to go before the town meeting?
Well, after all the roads get done. And the final paving gets done, the final marking, all the signs are in place.
So just approving the road, like we normally do.
Approving it, the road, and then the town meeting will get...
Automatically.
And the selectmen will get a vote from us to recommend acceptance by the town. And at that point, the town...
Okay.
At the time town meeting does it, then the selectmen do a formal taking of the road, and it gets filed in land court and all that stuff. And then from that day on, we own it.
No different than a normal development.
No, right. That is okay. Exactly.
And it
will
be all the roads, correct? All
no.
The
no, no,
no,
no.
Just the main road.
Just
the main road. Okay, sorry. Just the main road. Just one road. Legacy
no,
South.
No.
Yes.
No.
Right, so all
the roads.
South.
Yeah.
The whole town.
You taking me out for dinner later?
You better be going to a hotel too.
In a sewer, we're gonna throw in the sewer treatment plant.
What a deal!
I think. Do we have a motion already?
I did. Yes, I motioned. I thought.
Well, Cliff will move it.
I move.
Do we have a second then?
Not yet.
I will second it.
We have a second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote on extending the Legacy Farms South subdivision extension till September 30th, 2017? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Speaking of that, I think Roy is working for a road opening date on like a ribbon cutting for Legacy North. It's probably sometime in October, early November.
Yeah.
He's going to coordinate with the selectmen and maybe the Chamber of Commerce and make sure hopefully most of us can attend, and I think it's a big milestone for the town of opening that.
Are we going to try to get through you, Mr. Chair, the stop signs before that opening, or
it would be nice, but we'll
probably not.
The stop signs on Legacy are already there.
Yeah.
Oh, right. But we're looking at stop signs.
We're sending a letter. Excuse me, through the chair.
Yeah.
We're sending a letter to the selectmen anyway.
I understand, but I'm
I don't know whether they'll be able to get it done fast enough to do that.
Yeah, I don't think until like the 25th. So.
Yeah.
So we
will provide a bunch of sets of scissors for every member of the board to stand up and hold the ribbon across both lanes.
I would be proud to do that.
And then we will have a ceremonial parade of vehicles with maybe a flag or two going down the road and open the other end. Something kind of corny.
Put up a little tent and have refreshments.
Yeah, that would be nice.
We can't have big refreshments because...
Oh, yeah, right.
Can we start the marathon
very limited
this year? Yeah.
What do you mean limited?
Well, we can't accept anything.
We're stuck.
A coffee and a donut? I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Through you, Mr. Chair.
Bring your own.
Can I ask the applicant a question about his schedule?
Yeah.
When are you, you're going to line the street with trees?
Yep.
When do you anticipate putting those trees in?
Next spring.
Next spring? Okay.
Yeah, it's terrible yet.
I know, because of the drought, but my point being that the sooner we get the trees in, obviously, the quicker they can
absolutely.
Grow. So.
Okay.
Thank you.
But for the chair, that we had a discussion about that anyway, that we would put that off, right? Didn't we have?
Yeah,
yeah.
We just generalized and said landscaping. I was specifically asking about the trees.
Okay. That's part of the bond.
The ribbon cutting you want to do, is it better for you on a weekday or a weekend?
I don't know. Let's ask the boards.
I say weekend.
Weekend
works. Like a Saturday?
Like a Saturday, yeah.
Okay.
Only if it's nice weather.
That's the best answer.
Can't control that.
Yep. Okay, let's...
question about the road. Earlier on, there was we were discussing about naming, and people on the historical committee are kind of interested in talking to you about that.
That's up to the selectmen.
Right. But they
we don't get paid enough money to talk about
it. I've been directed to talk to Roy about it. So it's
up to the board.
Just for my curiosity, Mr. Chair, which road are we talking about? Just the one road or the little roads?
Franklin.
Oh, okay.
No, this is something else.
Talking about the little roads.
Okay. Next thing on legacy that I wanted to bring up as a future agenda item. While it's still reasonably good weather, we talked during all these public hearings about figuring out what to do with the north parcel. If I remember right, we kind of left that with you were going to get a big map of the north parcel and maybe show we're taking the road out here.
You're talking about an aerial.
Yeah.
It might be better if we do that, taking it, because we have a drone, we can fly over, but if we do it after the trees, the leaves fall,
okay. We'll
be able to see it much better. So if you'd like, probably in about a month, I can drone the whole thing and bring in you some big...
Or maybe you need some with some of the trees so we know what's there with it. But
I have ones already with the trees.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I mean, with the leaves.
But I think what we're looking to do is kind of what we said the last time. You know, this plot is going to be made into landscaping. This one is going to be let the trees grow because the LNG guy said let the trees grow up in the north part. This is going to be open meadow. This road we're going to get rid of. This road will become a trail.
Sure.
Just so we put our stamp of approval what it's going to look like at the end for that wonderful parcel.
We'll put that together.
It's going to be beautiful through the chair. I think the vista is just phenomenal.
Yep. Okay. So let's see. Let's try to get through some of the rest of this stuff here.
Mr. Chair, one more question for the applicant.
Mm-hmm.
Did you figure out who owns that piece of property between Wilson Street and the 180 homes? Remember there's that
high piece? I totally forgot about that. Okay. I'll look tomorrow.
Okay. Let's see. I think that's got everything that Roy's concerned with. For other information for the board, we got a new ZAC member who was from the ZBA, and that was?
Mark Hyman.
Okay, so they appointed him. Our ZAC met last month. Thursday, John Katina was reelected as chairperson of that committee. Like I said earlier, they're having their hearing on the 20th at 7:15. For Zach ideas.
He can go, right? He's all set.
Yeah, you're all set.
Thank you very much.
That's right.
Appreciate everyone.
Thank you.
Do we vote on this tonight?
No.
Okay.
I mean, we already voted that whoever they picked would be the member, and we just want to welcome him to the Zoning Advisory Committee as formally. At the hearing, the Zoning Advisory Committee will be taking ideas for zoning changes. There's two that I have. One is... a clarification maybe of reducing the setback in the agricultural district. Right now we require, I believe, 60 feet. And the fire chief says if you build a house that's 60 feet away from the road, you've got to have a 20-foot wide driveway. And if we might want to, and I'm not sure whether we would, but this would be a good one for Zach to look at, is make it 50 feet so that, you know, it's a question of large driveways versus a little bit further setback. And it's an interesting one. Yeah.
So I can report to you that they're kind of reanalyzing one and two family homes and the application of the code. And I think kind of what I look for is maybe if we get some continued dialogue, we just find a good public safety application for all of this so that it's not like a scenario on Hayden Row for the solar farms and something that we have some dialogue. But you may have some relief.
Great.
From that piece, I think there was some neat applications with some of the work that you did on North Mill where potentially you open a driveway up enough where I could swing an apparatus in, and maybe we study that some more and we find a compromise spot that would be good for a conversation towards a zoning bylaw change or something. I don't know the best avenue, so I'd be looking for some assistance and I could give you some input on
that,
what might work.
That's a good idea.
Excellent.
And certainly Zach can cover, you know, I'm not coming up with a solution. I just noticed that we have a potential problem that, you know, whatever. The other thing is, I think Zach needs to clarify, what is a restaurant and...
It's already on their list, I believe.
Okay, that's a clear one based on the lawsuit that's currently in front of the town at this point. So those are the only two that when I thought about it for about 10 minutes this afternoon that I put on my list. Usually my list is 4 or 5 long, but I guess I
have like a 6-item list already, but obviously.
But anyway, and you know, the public usually comes in with 1 or 2, mm-hmm. and some other committee might come in with 1 or 2, but and you're all welcome to come individually to that meeting if you thought something. If you can't come, I usually try to go to those meetings. I'd be happy to present whatever your idea is.
What date is that?
20th.
20th.
Of November? So
October.
Third floor, town hall.
Can you forward it to us?
It's right here in your printout.
You have a notice for it.
Zoning Advisory Committee. 7:15 p.m.
It's right here.
Questions, Mr. Chair?
Yep.
So anything in this book is game?
Not that book.
This book, the town bylaws?
That book is game, yeah.
The town bylaws?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
For what, David?
The meeting on the 20th.
Yep. Okay, we're getting close to the witching hour here. I'd like to take a motion to approve the minutes for August 15th, 2016, and only if nobody has any comments to those minutes.
I have a question.
Yep.
Were those included in our last packet?
Yes.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Are there any comments or questions to the minutes of the 22nd of August, 2016? Seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve such minutes.
I move.
Moved. I hear a second. All those in favor of approving minutes for August 22nd, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. For motion on September 12th minutes, I have a couple minor corrections. Of course, they're written very nicely. page 1 at the bottom line, and I'll give you these. I'll give you these.
Okay.
Instead of saying Mr. Refer to him as Chief.
Chief Slayman.
And the same with twice on page 5. And then I had one more on. Well, you can't search for Mister. Well, I guess you could. Yes.
I can.
And then there was just one word missing in number 8. Page 8. It says, Mr. Weissmantle, it is important to realize this is just a consequence. It should be probably Mr. Weissmantle said it is. But that was our, like,
minor in the last three meetings that we just approved, as usual.
You mean I'm getting an A minus?
No, that's still
straight,
an A.
That's a straight A.
So, any other changes to the minutes of September 12th? Seeing none, I will entertain a motion to approve such minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Here's those.
Okay.
Let's see. So we got minutes approved. Sidewalk discussion.
I'll be 2 seconds.
Yep.
Basic question is, in looking at various towns, what we were talking about was parking on the sidewalks, and there are provisions that are simply that. There are other provisions in some towns that relate to kind of blocking of sidewalks. Never relates to, there's always a provision saying a driveway, parking garage on the driveway doesn't block. But related to bushes, etc., that overgrow or block a sidewalk. My question is, do we want to leave it just for parking on it, or do we want to include anything else?
The question, I guess, is for the overgrowing, does the town have the right to cut somebody's bushes back if it's onto the town property? And that's, to me, a legal question, because I suspect they do.
Well, I would imagine those bylaws require the homeowner to cut back their own bushes so they don't block the street, both block the driveway, the sidewalk.
The visual? Or?
I would imagine. I mean, it's similar to some towns require homeowners to shovel the sidewalk in front of their homes.
Okay.
So.
True. I have two points to this that I'd like to clarify from my standpoint. Now, I probably shouldn't be voting on this at all, because first of all, my driveway at my house, I can't fit a vehicle in my driveway without blocking the sidewalk.
If you're in your driveway, it doesn't,
right.
It doesn't, it's not
right.
Considered
right.
Parking.
And that's
right.
What I see here.
Right.
So if I were to vote, I would not change that aspect.
But it's a town-wide question, so you...
Yes.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
Vote.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. All right, so then the second thing is that I find to be a very big concern is visualization. If that comes into safety issue, then we need to do something about what John has brought up as far as cutting.
I think his concern was pushing people out into the street while
right.
They're walking, if there's not enough room for someone to walk on the
right.
Sidewalk, because the tree or the bush or whatever is blocking it, they have to move out into the street. That
right.
is a safety issue.
Yes, yes. So I agree with that, that maybe we should consider something.
I certainly find it better to require maybe the homeowner to try to corral his own bushes.
Right, right.
Partly because some of those, in some of the examples that I know of were arborvitaes are now 30 years old that are taking up half the sidewalk.
Yeah.
It's going to be nasty when it's done, but I'd rather have the homeowner take care of the nasty effect.
I
don't know if anybody's ever seen down Lumber Street, but there's way down Lumber Street, there's like three or four houses together, there's the sidewalk there, and it's like, I don't think you can walk through there. I don't know.
It's throughout the town.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's great.
So I agree with you.
Bushes, trees.
So I think, am I sensing a consensus
more discussion?
Yeah,
please.
Well, please. Okay.
So
I will.
Sorry, I just had some input.
Okay.
I'm not sure I agree with no parking on sidewalks, because in developments, I see even the high school kids know that they're trying to get their car off the street and they pull up half like on the green belt and the sidewalk together. So I'm not sure. I'm totally committed.
So does that mean you can park on the sidewalk downtown? Because either you can park on the sidewalk or you can't park on the
sidewalk.
Well,
that's what I mean. It's like if you put a rule in, then you know technically a policeman can go tag all these cars in a neighborhood where the kids, in my opinion, are doing the right thing
right.
by trying to get off the street.
But on the flip side, if somebody parks on a sidewalk in front of Town Hall, you can't ticket them.
Should it be zoned?
If somebody is walking with a children on the sidewalk,
or a stroller,
or a stroller in a residential area, it's one thing. All the streets are technically wide enough to allow cars past if people park on the same side. So now what you're doing is you're forcing that mother with a child, so the car is not blocking the street. You're now forcing them to walk outside of the car, maybe 5 or 6 feet, you know, farther into the street.
Yeah.
So it's now no longer the car, which if it gets hit is a car. It's now a mother pushing a stroller that can get hit.
Yeah, no, those are all valid points.
I mean, if we look at the sidewalk, because we're now putting in sidewalks,
right.
I think we need to put a policy in place. I mean, why do they clean the sidewalks down Route 85 by the high school if you could park your car on it? There's no reason to take the snow off it. So I feel we need to come up with a comprehensive policy
that
not only covers cars, but obstructions to the sidewalk, like snow or overgrowth of bushes or trees. We need to come up with a policy that encompasses all of that, because at the end of the day, if someone goes out in the street and gets hit, who's liable for that? Are we the homeowner? Is the town?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to say, I couldn't walk on a public sidewalk because of X.
I think we've gotten to the point where we're trying to be much more pedestrian friendly.
Yes.
Correct.
And we're really pushing that way. And that's my 10 years on the board. That's something I've seen.
Correct.
You know, we've changed the mindset in the last 10 years. And so I think, policy.
Yeah, no, I was just.
So I think, John, you were looking for a little bit of direction.
Correct.
In order to come back to us with
some options.
Some good options.
Very good.
Okay, thank you very much for taking that on, John.
Okay. A liaison report, quickly?
Sure, go right ahead.
Through the Hopkinton Sustainable Green Committee and the efforts of Will Stearman, Make America Beautiful Hopkinton. Will is running a townwide cleanup event where people are meeting at 8:30, between 8:30 and 9:30 at Hopkinton High School on Saturday, October 22nd. So this is we do it in spring. This is a new fall effort to kind of get ahead of a lot of the trash and litter that's been around, blowing around, and get ready for winter. So Will's doing a really good job of leading this effort, and I hope to see people there at between 8:30 and 9:30 at the Hopkinton High School parking lot, October 22nd.
And then
they usually
provide dumpsters and stuff like that to get rid of stuff.
Gloves, bags, vests, the whole deal.
Oh, okay. Vests. Oh, I like that.
Okay. That's a good thing, Amy.
Thank you.
Other things in correspondence or reports, we did release the elementary school building decision. The site decision was released. We finally got the last set of drawings from them, and within a day, I think Jennifer had the decision ready to go, and we got it released.
Did we need signatures?
Nope.
And they're going to town. They've already started clearing.
And the selectmen have approved the tree clear cutting on North Mill Street for the driveway at their last meeting. So I just thought everyone would be kind of interested, given that.
Yes, thank you.
That we're on there. It is beyond the witching hour. We will not meet the goals today. We'll put that off to the next meeting.
Those poor goals are get lonely.
You know,
the goal right now is to just talk about the goals.
The goals are getting out there, but I'll tell you, I think we made a lot of progress on the master plan discussion today.
We
have not been able to finish for like 3 or 4 years.
Move to close the meeting.
Move to adjourn the meeting.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed, you can just stay. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you for the 20th.